The Brampton Thunder will have to win today if they want to extend their series to 3 against the Canadiens de Montréal after losing Game 1 7-1 last night at Étienne Desmarteaux Arena, where Montreal was 5-for-11 on the power play. Good evening, everyone. Welcome inside the Bell Sports Complex in beautiful Brossard, Quebec. I'm Robin Flynn alongside John Bauer. Thank you for joining us in what could be a winner-take-all game if Montreal wins.
The Canadiens looking to get back to the Clarkson Cup. Last year, they swept Toronto in the best-of-three semifinal series, the winning game here at the Complexe Sportif Bell in Brossard. So it'll be interesting to see what happens tonight. The Canadiens really came out with their A game yesterday, Robin, at in Montreal. And one of the things that doesn't surprise me was the power play of the Canadiens. The Fabs, we've seen them all season long dominate on the power play. But one of the things that I think Brampton will want to try to do today is staying out of the penalty box. It's a recipe for disaster, the number of times that they went to the sin bin yesterday. And that certainly has to be cause for concern for the Thunder, who are known as being one of the more physical teams in the league. But that's one of their forces as well. And that's one of the reasons why they've had such a good season, finishing third in the CWHL this campaign. It'll be... I think it's going to come down to goaltending today. If Charlene Devante is on her game again, it will be very difficult for Brampton. However, the Thunder do have the tools to be able to create opportunities, especially off of the cycle down low and the forecheck, to be able to get scoring chances and get some into the dirty area in the slot to try and bang home a rebound, get an early goal. And that's going to be their strategy in today's game, is to try and get the lead, play with the lead in this hockey game. Because the Canadiens, when they have the lead, they are very, very tough to come back against.
Well, one thing I noticed yesterday, head coach Danny Brunet was double-shifting Marie-Philippe Poulin early on in the game. It wasn't like they were down a goal. He was already double-shifting his best players. And that's something Brampton didn't do until they found themselves down. So I'm expecting to see Jess Jones, Jamie Lee Rattray getting significantly more ice time tonight. And you mentioned they have to stay out of the box. They're the most penalized team in the league. They took 11 penalties yesterday. Montreal 5-for-11 on the power play. They have the best power play in the league. You can't give them opportunities like that.
And when you take a look at the scoring depth of Les Canadiens, you know, you take a look, Jess Jones and Marie-Philippe Poulin finished with 37 points at the top of the scoring charts this year. But then you take a look at the next two, Anne-Sophie Bété, Caroline Ouellette, Montreal. Then you go down a little bit further. You get Laura Stacey from Brampton.
What a season she's had, by the way. Rookie of the Year nominee. She led all rookies in scoring.
Should probably win the Rookie of the Year award.
I should think so.
So, you know, you start taking a look at that, but there's a drop-off. There's a significant drop-off from Caro at 31 down to 25 points and further down. So when you take a look at the amount of scoring depth and threat that the Canadiens have, you cannot give them the opportunities to go on the advantage. We've seen it time and time again that they have dominated over the last 4 or 5 seasons in the power play category. When they get the advantage, and there's a lot of games that they don't get a lot of power plays. It's not necessarily the quantity, it's the quality of power play opportunities. The Canadiens, if they score 2-3 goals on the advantage, well, they're going to have a good chance of winning. Now, Brampton is very good on the PK as well on the road.
They have to be. They take so many penalties. They have to learn how to be successful.
They're the best road team on the PK, on the power play at 34%, but on the penalty kill, they're middle of the – well, actually, they're a little bit lower than middle of the pack, but they're still at 82% efficiency on the PK. That took an obvious hit yesterday. So the one thing that they're going to want to try to do is, again, we'll harp on this a little bit, stay out of the penalty box, create scoring opportunities with their forecheck, and hope that Jess Jones can really get into the flow and dictate a little bit of the play, like she has done in the past in this building.
Brampton also has so much depth on the back end, and that is something that has been to their advantage, right? They have so many incredible talents, like Laura Fortino, who is more than capable of jumping in and pinching in when she needs to, and her fellow Olympian, Jocelyn Larocq. I think what really hurt them right now is not having Sarah Edney, who is second in points among D-men. She's not playing right now, so that's definitely hurt them on the back end.
If we take a look back to a year ago on Super Bowl Sunday a year ago, we did a game here at between these two teams, and it was the PK, the special team for Brampton, that gave them a chance to stay in that game. They played very well defensively, despite falling in that contest, and that's exactly it. You know, they do have a very young blue line that is very aggressive, They will be in your face all night long.
And that's not to denigrate Montreal's blue line either,
not
right?
Not at all.
They have a lot of depth this year, but it's young.
Yes.
Cassandra Poudrier has had a fantastic season, but she's a rookie. Brittany Fouracres, great year, but she's a rookie. These girls are still learning, and they're fortunate to be learning under players like Cathy Chartrand.
Exactly, and the depth that the Canadiens do have is that it allows them to mitigate some of the rookie errors that we saw earlier in the season, the game at the Bell Centre against Calgary. We saw some blue line turnovers. Poudrier had a couple of times in the first two periods where she had difficulty getting the puck up ice quickly to get it out of the zone. Some turnovers at the blue line, etc. So, you know, these are things that young blue liners, when they take the step up from the university ranks to the CWHL, it does take some time to learn. And it's going to be interesting to see what happens here this afternoon as the Canadiens lead this best of three semifinal series, one game to none. In the other semi-series last night,
wow,
the Toronto Furies taking game one out in Calgary. A bit of a shock.
Yeah, by a score of 5-2, Danelle Kohanchuk had a hat trick. Erin Ambrose, multi-point game. Renata Fast, multi-point game. So they got a lot of help from their blue line as well. It was, to say it was a shock is an understatement. Calgary was expected to sweep that series in two, and for Toronto to take it in game one where they don't have last change. That's the thing about the best of three series. One team hosts it, but the away team is technically the home team in the second game. So today you'll see that Brampton will have last change. So yesterday, Toronto didn't even have last change and they still managed to beat them.
But they were 2-for-5 on the power play. So again, the power play helps Montreal in the semifinal here in the opening game. Toronto 2-for-5. Out in Calgary, but take a look at the shots on goal last night. 49 for Calgary versus 27 for Toronto. So, you know, that's the type of stuff that you can't be doing. And from what we understand, Toronto has taken a 1-0 lead already out in Calgary in game number two. And Robin and I were talking off air that this would not surprise us seeing Toronto winning this game tonight. Listen, Boston's getting better.
Right.
They're getting better. But the top four teams in this league,
it's a dog pile.
Anybody can win. It is not a given that Toronto will sweep that series or that Calgary will win the next two games.
Which was the case last year. When we went into the semifinals, it was very clear that Calgary was going to beat Brampton and Montreal was going to beat Toronto, and it was an easy series. I would say that Calgary had a tougher time against Brampton than Montreal had against Toronto, and that probably helped them for the Clarkson Cup. I spoke to assistant head coach Lisa Marie Breton-Lebreu earlier this week after practice, and she said, we didn't face enough adversity last season. We didn't have any opportunity to prove what we were made of. Everything was so easy. Whereas this year, that wasn't the case for Montreal. They had some bumps in the roads, and they learned how to deal with them together as a team. And I think that that has helped them. If they can get past Brampton in the semifinals, whether they go on to face Calgary or Toronto, I would say they would have the advantage.
Well, and if you take a look back to a year ago, Calgary was on that run. You know, they had to win that last weekend series against Brampton in Brampton to be able to go home to host the Thunder in the semifinal round, which they did, en route to their first Clarkson Cup championship. So the Canadiens, as you mentioned, didn't have that adversity. Although, you know, the game against Toronto was not, the two games against Toronto, the first game actually was a lot tighter than the second game. The second game was dominated. Julie Chu, who came off of coaching a game at Concordia University that afternoon, changing in the back of her dad's car as they're coming across the bridge. To Brassard, she scores a pair of goals in that game.
She technically scored a hat trick. One was given to Carolyn Ouellette. It turned out she had tipped it in, but I like to say that she scored a hat trick showing up late, which is because it's a better story that way. We are at the Bell Sports Complex in Brassard, by the way, just waiting for the game to start. A little bit of a delay, so we apologize. Just bear with us. The players will be jumping out onto the ice shortly, and then we'll hear Alyssa Donay sing the national anthem. John.
Now, speaking of Julie Chu doing that last year, she did the same thing today. Except for this time, her team, the Concordia Stingers, defeated the defending national university champions from the Université de Montréal to eliminate them in two games. So Julie is in fine spirits coming here to the Bell Complex here in Brossard this afternoon. So we'll see if that parlays into some on-ice results as well.
I spoke to her after the Canadiens 7-1 win over Brampton last night, congratulating her on being named RSEQ Coach of the Year. And she said, you know what, it's all my coaching staff. I have such a great team behind me, but the coaching staff this year has really, really upped our game. which is, you know, her teammates are her coaching staff.
Well, so this is the funny part. At the end of the game, when this, because Montreal tied the game up with about 3.5 to go, and then Concordia won it with 2:50 left in regulation time on a goal. As soon as the game was over, Laurien Rougeau and Caroline Ouellette were seen running out of the Ed Mahar Arena to get over here. Julie, of course, had to go through all the rituals at the end of the game. So, you know, there's an incredible depth there, and, you know, they could be coaching against Charlie and Miguel next week in the RSCQ Championship.
Wouldn't that be something? And there's also another big game in town next week. Not in town, it's in Kanata at the Canadian Tire Center. The Clarkson Cup Final will be played. Tickets are available, by the way, if you want to buy them. Go to the CWHL's website, thecwhl.com, and you can buy your tickets. I'll be there. It's going to be a really great day. I guess it depends for you on what happens in the RSCQ Championship.
Yeah, exactly. As the convener and as the... as the associate director at Concordia, we'll have to see what happens, but my plans already include a little detour to Kanata and to Canadian Tire Center. Tickets are very, very reasonably priced. Again, as you know, they're $20 a person. Come on out, support the league. We've seen big crowds at the Bell Center this year. We've seen big crowds out of the Saddle Dome in Calgary for the Inferno playing a game out there. We saw a massive crowd at Air Canada Center a couple of weeks ago for the All-Star Game. So let's try and increase and set a record for the Clarkson Cup Championship this year out in Ottawa. And the Senators do a fantastic job in making the focus be on the CWHL during the entire weekend up in Ottawa. So it's fantastic that way.
Yeah, 4 p.m. game time next Sunday afternoon at the Canadian Tire Center in Kanata, Ontario, near Ottawa, if you're curious where Kanata is. And if you can't get out there, the game will be on Sportsnet television, so you can watch the game that way. So whatever you do, anything counts. If you're watching the game, you're counting towards the ratings. If you're there, you're counting in the attendance. So make sure you're doing at least one or the other.
And I do believe that for our friends down in Boston, the game will also be on a CWHL website, as Sportsnet does not have the rights in the United States for the championship.
Yep, so you'll be able to watch it on CWHL's YouTube stream, which you're doing right now. So we thank you so much for hanging out with us here in Brossard. You know, John, you mentioned a little bit earlier about goaltending and it potentially being a goaltending duel today. It looks like Charlene Labonte will get her second straight start after winning last night 7-1. Brampton head coach Tyler Fine said before the game even started yesterday that he was going Erica Howe, Liz Knox. So it looks like Liz Knox will probably get the start today. I don't know if that's necessarily the decision I would make, or to make that decision before even seeing how game one shook out is interesting.
Well, but they do tend to rotate the goaltenders through it. And then, you know, I've had the privilege of covering Liz Knox's career back to when she was playing for the Laurier Golden Hawks. She is a clutch goaltender in big games. She did it when she was with Laurier winning a national championship. She's been at the Olympics as a softball player. So she is somebody who knows what it's like to play a game late in the regular season.
So it looks like Brampton is skating out, not wearing their usual jerseys. They're wearing a different jersey for today's broadcast.
The Brossard jerseys. And this actually would explain something. Because if they're the home team, they're supposed to be wearing... No, they'll be wearing whites. They're out there in their whites in warm-up.
Yeah, a little confusing. Hopefully they're all wearing the same numbers, or else this should be an interesting game to call.
Well, let's just see. Is there a 44 on the roster? No, there's not. This is going to be a challenge for us. So, we will hopefully be able to get a roster...
Well, the Canadiens are just getting ready to skate out onto the ice. You got your flag bearers standing by, ready to wave them on as the coaching staff walks across and makes their way towards the bench. Brampton at their net, getting amped up. And it remains to be seen where the Canadiens are. They should be stepping out onto the ice very, very shortly. We thank you so much for spending your afternoon with us here in Brossard at the Bell Sports Complex as we get ready for game two of the CWHL semifinals between the Brampton Thunder and the Montreal Canadiens, affectionately now known as the Fabs, as Charlene Labonte leads Montreal out onto the ice to the thunderous applause of the Brossard crowd. So we apologize for the delay in getting the game started. Here it is, 1-0 Toronto over Calgary in game two of the other game that is happening, the other semifinal series. Toronto won that game yesterday by a score of 5-2. And we'll have a new lineup sheet for you shortly as the Brampton Thunder are not wearing their usual numbers as they are wearing Brossard jerseys this afternoon at the Bell Sports Complex. Standing by now to hear our national anthem as sung by Alyssa Donet, regular anthem singer here for Les Canadiens de Montréal. She'll be stepping out onto the ice shortly to get this crowd hyped up. CWHL Commissioner Brenda Andrus is in the house this afternoon. She will join us during one of the intermissions, as will Jared Book, who contributes to Habs Eyes on the Prize for coverage of Les Canadiens, as well as the rest of the CWHL for the Ice Garden, part of the SB Nation network. We'll go over some of the award nominees before the Clarkson Cup next Sunday. There's an award gala on Friday. And we'll talk about who got nominated for what. We already mentioned Laura Stacey being nominated for Rookie of the Year. She'll likely be a shoo-in to win that one, but we'll run that down for you during one of the intermissions. Let's go now to the ice level and hear our starting lineups. Lineup for the Brampton Thunder. Same lineup, but they'll be wearing different numbers, and we'll make sure we have those changes for you. Jess Jones will be wearing number 10. That's a number you'll be seeing on the ice a lot, so make sure you know that one. Liz Knox getting the start in goal for Brampton. Charlene Labonte will be your starter for Montreal. Starting lineup, as per usual, on the back end, Lauriane Rougeau, along with rookie Cassandra Poudrier up front, Marie-Philippe Poulin, Carolyn Ouellette, and Anne-Sophie Bette, all three in the top five in scoring in the CWHL this season. Marie-Philippe Poulin and Anne-Sophie Bette, also nominees for the Jaina Hefford Trophy this season. That's the MVP as voted by their peers. Everybody, every player in the league votes on that award. So that is nice to see Anne-Sophie Bette getting some recognition that way as the crowd cheers for Carolyn Ouellette. The biggest cheers for Captain Marie-Philippe Poulin, co-winner of the Angela James Bowl this season with Jess Jones of the Brampton Thunder, both with 37 points this season.
So we are still working through all the lineup changes here, and we'll get them for you in a few moments' time with the numbers. We're working off of a game sheet down in the booth, so we will we'll have all these different things, and hopefully we'll have everything in about 2 minutes time after the national anthem.
And it's time now for the national anthem as everybody in the building gets to their feet and faces towards the flags at the end of the rink as Alyssa Donet starts singing.
Ton histoire.
Beautiful rendition of O Canada as sung by Alyssa Dene, regular anthem singer for Les Canadiens. Their last game at the Brossard Arena, their final regular season home game of the season, it was Anne-Sophie Bette who sang the national anthem, much to the delight of her teammates. The only person who knew she was going to be singing that afternoon was Carolyn Ouellette, who had personally asked her to sing the anthem. And I think that Anne-Sophie did a terrific job with her bilingual rendition of O Canada. She's been taking singing lessons and piano lessons. She's quite an accomplished person, that Anne-Sophie Bette.
And an incredible businesswoman as well, as a financial planner. Okay, so we have the lineup changes here for you. So they're wearing the Brossard jerseys tonight. Here are the numbers. Becca King is 32, Jocelyn Larocque, 21, Laura Stacey, 72, Laura Fortino, 82, Kristen Richards, 33, Rebecca Vint, 38, Fielding Montgomery is 16, Nicole Brown, 96, Jessica Hartwick, 5, Dania Simmons, 85, Shannon McCauley, 3, Jess Jones, 10, Courtney Bierschard, 14, number 66, Taylor Woods, Rat Rates still at 26, Wandsburg 78, Knox 3, and we'll get to the rest in a few moments.
And Brampton wins the opening draw against Anne-Sophie Bette as Marie-Philippe Poulin was tossed from the circle. So you'll have to bear with me as I'm learning an entirely new bunch of numbers this afternoon. As Montreal skates into the offensive zone, Marie-Philippe Poulin has the puck. She goes in to take a shot, and she beats Liz Knox with a backhanded wrister. It is 1-0 Montreal.
That was the start that the Canadiens were looking for, not what Brampton was looking for. 16 seconds into the hockey game, a turnover just inside the Canadiens' blue line, comes back the other way, and Marie-Philippe Poulin goes left to right across the face of the goal and just chips it over the pad of Liz Knox to give Les Fabs a 1-0 lead.
Interesting to see Marie-Philippe Poulin losing the draw off the top. Not something she does very often, losing faceoffs, but it seemed to work out just fine for Montreal. As you mentioned, that turnover, they were able to get the puck, and once Marie-Philippe Poulin is skating into the offensive zone, look out. And Montreal wins their next faceoff as won by Marie-Philippe Poulin. With possession now is Anne-Sophie Bette. She dumps it in behind Liz Knox, who goes around to poke it back into the corner where Carolyn Ouellette picks it up. A little bit of a battle along the boards with Brampton, where Brampton goes to retrieve it. And Anne-Sophie Bette is there. Around the other side, Cassandra Poudrier chipping along as Brampton gets control of the puck and dumps it into Montreal territory. Sarah Lafort is there, skates behind her own net with the puck. She passes it forward to Anne-Sophie Bette, who chips it into neutral territory where Brampton retrieves the puck. Marie-Philippe Poulin's first goal of the playoffs. She had 3 assists in Montreal's 7-1 win yesterday. Katia Clément-Hedra sends it back to Julie Chu, who pinches into the corner, leaves it for Carol Amard, who sends it back to Clément-Hedra at the blue line, who takes the shot, and that one is gloved by Liz Knox. Stoppage of play at 18:47 to go in the first period.
So Poulin, her first from Bette and Ouellette at 16 seconds of the first period. Now you talk about a quick score. How about in the other semifinal? Early in that hockey game, it's 1-1 as the goals, Natalie Spooner at 2:45 and Haley Irwin for Calgary at 11:34.
And Emmanuel Blay has the puck, dumps it into the corner where Jordana Peroff is tripped up, Noémie Marin is. As Deschaine loses her stick, Canadien bodies falling all over the ice. Brampton has it, skates it behind Liz Knox as they carry the puck out of their zone through neutralized territory and dump it into the offensive zone. Puck goes behind Charlene Labonte's net, where she dumps it into the corner. Kim Deschaine pokes it out. Brampton sticks it back in, and they'll have to skate off for a line change.
So Jocelyn Larocque, wearing number 21, was the one that got the puck up a couple of times into the offensive zone there, but unable to create any scoring chances.
A 1-on-3 for Marie-Philippe Poulin. She hangs on to the puck along the board, sends it cross ice for Anne-Sophie Bette, who takes a shot, and that one is tipped away by Brampton. Carolyn Ouellette puts it in front for Marie-Philippe Poulin, who gets a shot off. That one is stopped by Liz Knox's pad. Back to the blue line for 4 acres. She sends it into the corner for Anne-Sophie Bette. She drops it off for Marie-Philippe Poulin. Back up forward to the circle for Bette. To the blue line where 4 acres sends it across for Carly Hill. bounces it off the boards where Brampton picks it up as they'll try and clear the zone so they can get a little bit of respite. Maybe a line change at this point is needed. Some rubbing up along the boards. Brampton finally does get control of the puck, and they will clear the zone through neutral territory and skate right into Montreal's zone, where Carly Hill is able to poke it forward, and Anne-Sophie Bette will effortlessly carry it out of the zone through neutral territory and dump it in as Montreal goes for a line change.
A few moments ago, Marie-Philippe Poulin had a great scoring opportunity on the doorstep. Good pass from behind the net by Caroline Ouellette as she saw daylight on the five-hole, tried to sneak it through, but Knox was able to get the right pad down just enough to stop the puck from going between the wickets.
Skating forward now is Brampton behind the net. Ooh, Charlene Labonte is forced to get down to the butterfly and make a pad save as Brampton tips the puck on goal.
That was Shannon McCauley, number 3 for Brampton. And again, we apologize for this, but Brampton is wearing a Brassard Junior Hockey uniform. We're not sure exactly why. We'll find that out as the game goes on tonight.
Well, during the practice, they were both wearing white jerseys, so I'm not sure. Maybe Brampton didn't bring their dark jerseys.
Uniforms, and that's what I think it might be, is that they were assuming that they were the visiting team in all three games, and at the same time, Les Canadiens would have only brought their white jerseys.
Brampton now has the puck in neutralized territory, dumps it into the Canadiens zone, and they'll go off for a change.
Or actually could have been the other way around. The Canadiens thought that they were playing with their whites today as well.
Some bumping and grinding along the Brampton bench with Emmanuelle Blay, not somebody you want to go up against. She's a CrossFit trainer as well, and is probably one of the strongest players in the CWHL. Brampton now has the puck, gets it out of their zone through neutralized territory. It's a 2-on-1 right now. Brampton unable to get the shot off as Julie Chu.
And a high sticking call coming against Les Canadiens as Blay got her stick up against the Brampton attacker coming into the defensive zone.
And Emmanuelle Blay will go off. That gives Brampton their first power play opportunity of the game. They had the second best power play in the CWHL this season, and they're really good on the road. Their power play on the road as well is best in the league. They managed a 34.1% power play efficiency, and they get the offensive zone draw back to the blue line for Brampton. They send it forward, trying to tip it in. They're unable to get a shot on goal. Behind the net, skating into the corner, back up to the blue line. Cross ice pass as they change positions to the circle. Taking the shot, unable to get a tip on Charlene Labonte, back up to the blue line. Rebecca Vint fires it, unable to get it through.
So Vint's in front of the goal, and her big presence there, Robin, I think is going to be one of the things we talked about, right? You need to get the big player in front of the goal, try and create some traffic in front of Labonte, and create a scoring chance for Brampton here, down 1-0 very early on in the hockey game.
In the corner, Cassandra Poudrier fires it along the boards, trying to get it out, but Brampton picks it up in the corner, sends it through the slot, where Anne-Sophie Bette picks it up shorthanded and dumps it into the offensive zone, where she picks it up, and she goes, takes the shot, and beats Liz Knox stick side. Anne-Sophie Bette, unassisted breakaway goal. It's 2-0 Montreal, shorthanded goal.
Bette, who had 3 shorties during the regular season, has the puck up on the near side, and a foot race with the blue liner, just chips it off of the sideboards of the blue line, and then she cuts inside on the rear guard for Brampton, picks up her own bank pass off of the boards, just at the top of the right wing faceoff circle, goes in and goes up over the blocking arm of Liz Knox to make it 2-0, a shorthanded goal, 4 minutes and 50 seconds into the first period.
And Clement Hadra will win the draw as the Montreal dumps the puck into the Brampton zone. Brampton has control of the puck. And they carry it through neutralized territory, get past Jordana Peroff, where they're tripped up at the blue line. And will we have a tripping call?
It's a hook, actually.
A hook, okay. So that's Jordana Peroff going off for the hook, as Brampton now will have a 5-on-3 opportunity for 47 seconds, down 2-0. Just over 5 minutes into the first period, in a do-or-die game for the Thunder. If they lose this afternoon, their playoffs, their season is over.
Brampton was 0-for-2 last night on the power play, and they're already down 1. Even though they have a 2-player advantage here, they've given up a shorty, so they need to get one back here to try and get back in this hockey game.
Laura Stacey taking the draw against Marie-Philippe Poulin. Poulin wins it, sends it back into the corner, where there's a battle with 2 Brampton players. Poulin jumps in to help out. Brampton makes away with it, sends it up to the blue line. sends it to the circle. Back in the corner, going for a little skate and back up to her defenseman. She moves and changes places with her other blue liner, who sends it in front of Charlene Labonte, who tips it away, scramble in front of the net as Labonte sprawls on her stomach to cover up the puck. 22 seconds left on the 5-on-3 with 14:29 to go in the first period.
And in front of the goal, battling for the puck there, as we are still, it was Jess Jones standing on the doorstep. She gets knocked down as she tries to poke the loose puck that was just to the left of Charlene Labonte past her. So.
Face off to the left of Charlene Labonte, won by Montreal. They try to clear the zone, but are unable to do so. Kathy Chartrand stays the course in front of her woman, her man. Brampton, cross-ice pass, trying to get another shot on Labonte. They aren't able to do so as Kathy Chartrand is there to tip it away. Brampton now, 3 seconds left on the 5-on-3. Sends it wide of Charlene Labonte, and that one will bobble out over the blue line as the penalty expires to Emmanuel Blais. Brampton has 1:06 left with a 5-on-4 advantage with Perroff still in the box for a hooking call. Puck goes into the corner where Kathy Chartrand is there. Brampton picks up the puck. They shoot it on Charlene Labonte, who covers up the puck, loses sight of it. Brampton grabs it in the corner on the near side, sends it up to the blue line. Back along the boards, some shifting, some moving along, trying to get the shot through to Labonte, and Brampton scores! Power play goal with Jordana Perroff in the box. Brampton has cut Montreal's lead in half with 13:37 to go in the first period. It's 2-1.
That's a huge goal for Brampton, getting back into this hockey game at the 6:23 mark of this first period. They had everything going against them. 16 seconds in, Poulin scores in the shorthanded by Bette. So offset the shorty by Bette at 4:50. And now they have a chance to continue to mount the comeback.
As Montreal wins yet another faceoff, Julie Chu has it in neutralized territory. Katia Klemahedra loses it to Brampton. They try and do a little skate to get into the offensive zone. Brampton has it. They'll skate back into their own zone, try and gain control of the puck. Brampton has it. And again, we do apologize, Brampton not wearing their usual jersey numbers this afternoon, wearing Brassard jerseys. The puck was tipped out of play there.
So it's Jess Jones, who is wearing number 10 right now, from Jimmy Lee Rattray, wearing her normal 26. So at 6 minutes and 23 seconds of the first period.
So I guess that explains the delay for the start of the game. I guess all these girls had to find some new jerseys to wear.
Yes, and fortunately Brassard Hockey had these very black uniforms with dark numbers on them kind of hanging around.
What luck. Brampton now has it. Skates into the offensive zone. We're at 5-on-5 here. Puck goes behind Charlene Labonte, where Emmanuel Blais picks it up to clear the zone. Sends it through neutral ice for Noemie Marin. She goes in towards Liz Knox, takes the shot, and Liz Knox gets a piece of that one, goes up and over her shoulder into the corner, where Kim Deschene has lost her stick trying to cross-check a couple players in the back. She was cross-checked in the face last night by... cross-checked her in the face last night. Hartwick. Marie-Philippe Poulin collects the puck in the corner. Sends it to the blue line for Chartrand, who fires it on Liz Knox, and that one goes wide into the corner where Carolyn Ouellette tries to grab it. Marie-Philippe Poulin gets a stick on it. Back in the corner where Anne-Sophie Bété bumps up with Brampton, who are bringing the thunder this afternoon as Jess Jones carries it into the Montreal zone, dumps it in behind Labonte. Brampton tries to get a shot. That one just goes wide of Labonte. Back around behind the net where Poulin picks it up, sends it to Chartrand for Ouellette. Tries to clear the zone but isn't able to do so. Gets the puck back. Finally gets it through to center ice, and that'll be an icing call. 11:36, 2-1 the score in the first period.
Well, partner, I've done some very interesting broadcasts over the years from behind plate glass windows, behind the net, because a broadcast line has never been put in. But I've never actually done a game where
we have no idea who's who.
Exactly, the numbers have been changed the last minute. So again, we apologize to our fans down in Brampton, where we are slowly learning the roster here with these new uniforms.
Ooh, puck gets trapped in Carolyn Ouellette's feet as a rocket from the blue line doesn't make it through, blocked by Ouellette. Charlie now covers it up in front. And things getting a little bit chippy as they did last night. Let's hope it doesn't escalate the way it did in the final few minutes. In the last 2.5 minutes last night, 3 Brampton players were ejected. And I'm sure that Coach Tyler Fiennes doesn't want that to happen again this afternoon.
Daniel Simmons with a shot from the left point that was knocked down in front by Ouellette. But Caro had her stick tied up as she was trying to get the stick down to clear it. And that's what created a little skirmish in front of the net.
Brampton wins the faceoff, sends it in behind Charlene Labonte into the corner, where Brittany Fouracres picks it up, tries to get it free for Carol Amard. Brampton waiting at the blue line, takes a shot. That one gets through. Charlene Labonte gets a piece of it and clears it in front of her. Back behind the net is the puck. Sarah LaFour battles to get control, loses her stick. She grabs it back up. Puck goes along the boards. Brampton has it, sends it back to the far side, takes the shot, and that one is tipped out, or blocked rather, by Charlene Labonte. Brampton again resetting, coming on strong, takes another shot on Labonte. She gets the elbow up and knocks the puck out of the way. Carly Hill trying to clear the puck now as they finally manage to do so, not for long.
So Bierschart with a pair of shots high to the blocker side. I wonder if they're trying to exploit something on Charlie, because all 3 shots on that last rush, Robin, were to the high to the blocking side on the veteran tender for Les Canadiens.
Not sure if there's really a book on Charlene Labonte.
No.
It's tough to beat her anywhere. Yesterday they beat her 5-hole. Another shot taken on Charlene Labonte in the butterfly. She kicks that away with the pad. Kim Deschain has the puck in center ice, but she loses it. Brampton tips it back into their offensive zone. Charlene Labonte settles the puck, sends it back behind for Lauriane Rougeau. She pauses, decides what she wants to do with it, sends it forward for Kim Deschain, who clears the zone to center ice, where Noemi Marin collides with a Brampton player. Brampton sends it back into Montreal territory. Charlene Labonte settles the puck behind her own net, and that is knocked into the corner. Emmanuel Blais for Kim Deschain. Marie-Philippe Poulin now skating into the zone. It's a 1-on-3. Could have been offside. She takes the shot, and that one is wide. Emmanuel Blais wasn't able to pick up the rebound. In the corner now is Poulin. She sends it to the blue line for Kathy Chartrand. Julie Chu sends it back to Kathy Chartrand in the high slot. She takes the shot, and that one's way over Liz Knox. Puck into the corner, and it tips out where Kathy Chartrand settles it at center ice. Carolyn Ouellette skating it back in as everyone gets onside. She goes in towards Liz Knox, takes the shot. Amazing right pad save by Knox to keep this a 2-1 hockey game with less than 10 minutes to go in the first period.
And Kathy Chartrand was the player driving towards the goal off of the left side, trying to get the tip.
Jess Jones now skating the puck into Brampton territory, and there's an offside call as she tried very, very hard to keep it onside, doing the splits over the blue line, but wasn't quite able to do so, was Laura Stacey.
But it was a good job by Bette to also push Jones forward into the offensive zone as she was trying to make that last little move by lifting her stick and just getting a little bit of interference on her. It forced the play offside.
And the puck goes back into Montreal territory, where we're seeing an awful lot of this hockey game being played since Brampton found themselves back on the board. It's a 2-1 hockey game, and Montreal Brampton has been pushing really hard. Sarah LaFour now skating it into the Brampton territory, dumps it for Clément Hadra. She sends it forward for LaFour. Beautiful forward pass by Clément Hadra. She has it now in the high slot, tips it through traffic, but that one is knocked away by Brampton. They pick it up in the corner with Carol Amard in front as Montreal goes for the change. Brampton sending it back and forth behind Liz Knox, deciding what to do as they skate it through center ice and into Montreal territory. Settling the puck, sending it forward in front of Labonte, unable to get a shot on goal. Montreal grabs the puck and tries to clear the zone. Brittany Fouracres now back for Poudrier, who falls to her knees and loses sight of the puck. No, luckily for her, Noemi Marin is there. She settles the puck behind Labonte as everybody shifts positions on the ice. And Danny Brunet waves at Marin, letting her know what she should be doing here.
And Robin, Rebecca King was the one that lifted the stick to force Les Canadiens back behind the net. And then she dropped back instead of keeping pressure on them. But eventually, it creates an icing call because Brampton was waiting to... They were forcing the play by actually just sitting there, waiting to see what the Les Canadiens were going to do. So after after Becca King came in with the stick check deep in the offensive zone, forcing Les Canadiens back behind their own goal, what happens? well, it became a bit of a who blinks first situation, and it was LeCanadien who iced the puck.
And in Brampton's next offensive opportunity, the puck goes in behind Labonte. Everybody falls to the ice. Puck ball bobbles out into the corner where Noémie Marin has it. Battle along the boards. In steps in Four Acres to help out. Puck gets free. Manuel Blake clears the zone as the puck trickles into Brampton territory where they retrieve it. And Montreal goes off for a partial line change. Brampton now into Montreal territory. Marie-Philippe Poulin and Carly Hill managed to clear the zone as Brampton will now go for a line change. Behind the net is Four Acres. Sends it forward for Poulin. She goes in. She has Carolyn Ouellette behind her. She goes to take the shot, and that one is quite wide of Liz Knox's stick side. Poulin falls along the half wall. Carolyn Ouellette is there. Her stick was being held by the Brampton player.
Had a glove pass in the offensive zone being called against LeCanadien. Julie True out there asking why the call is being made there. It was interesting. Jocelyn Larocq, number 21, came back. Good stick check in the defensive zone again. And Brampton is just trying to get into the lanes in the defensive zone so that Montreal's not able to get their good rhythm of passes in the offensive zone.
Sarah LaFour has it now behind Liz Knox. Brampton gets control of the puck themselves. Puck squeezes loose. Bit of a battle along the boards to get it. Katia Clément-Hedra winds up being the one to come free with it, but she's got Brampton on her six as she falls to the ice trying to get the puck towards her line mate, Sarah LaFour. Carolyn Mard has it. She had a two-goal game yesterday in game one. She collides violently with a Brampton player to the point for Julie Chu. She sends it back behind Liz Knox. Puck comes in front, but there's no one there to get a shot off. There's already some physical play happening in game two of this semifinal series. Brampton takes a shot, and that one goes right in the logo on Labonte, who makes the save. 2-1 Montreal with 5:54 left to go in the first period.
Laura Stacey with the shot coming in off of the right side. You're not going to beat Charlie Labonte from above the rings on the outside too often, but again, shot to the blocker side.
And during the first intermission, John, you will be speaking with Jess Jones,
the
leading scorer
will.
For the Brampton Thunder, who has been on the ice quite a bit this evening. We mentioned Tyler Fines needing to double shift her early, and it's something he has obviously done. Noémie Marin sends the puck out. Brampton grabs it at their own blue line. Skates it through center ice territory. Loses control of the puck, where Marin knocks it into Brampton territory. And they're able to keep it along the line, held by Cassandra Poudrier, who tries to get the shot on Knox. In the corner now is Kim Deschaine. Goes for a skate along the board. Sends it back into the corner for Emmanuel Blais. She sends it to Poudrier at the top of the circle, who shot is tipped up over Liz Knox. Back into the corner now is Poulin, who is tripped. And there will be another power play coming for Montreal. 5:13 left to go in the first period. Montreal 5-for-11 yesterday on the power play.
Ronsberg gets the trip out on Marie-Philippe Poulin down in the left wing corner in the offensive zone. So LeCanadien, as you said, 5-for-11 last night on the power play. The top home power play team in the circuit, and overall with 24.7% efficiency. They were 13-of-47 between the various home games across the province of Quebec this year.
It was nice to see Montreal sort of touring all over at various rinks. That's in Desmarteaux, this beautiful rink in Brossard, and in La Beauce, near the hometown of Marie-Philippe Poulin and Lisa-Marie Breton-Lebreu, which was a really fun weekend against the Boston Blades. Montreal wins the faceoff, where Julie Chu has it, sends it for Carolyn Ouellette at the point. She settles the puck, sends it forward for Anne-Sophie Bété at the half wall. She goes to take the shot on Liz Knox. She makes the save, but that one is in front. Scramble back up to Poulin, high slot to the circle for Carolyn Ouellette. She skates forward, changes places with Poulin at the circle, who takes the one-timer shot, and that one is knocked away by Liz Knox. Poulin has it, back for Anne-Sophie Bété. Cross ice for Carolyn Ouellette for Poulin at the high slot. She takes the shot, and that one gets by Liz Knox. Power play goal for Marie-Philippe Poulin, her second of the game. It's 3-1 Montreal.
In front of the net through that entire power play was Carla Lemar. She was working the screen just before the goal was scored. Anne-Sophie Bethea came out of the right wing corner and rifled a rocket earmarked for the top shelf glove side that Knox was able to stop. But this time, with all the traffic in front and Imar very much in front of Knox, she had no chance of making the save as she was screened. A power play goal for Les Canadiens, and it's 3-1.
Nice to see Carol Amard getting some power play time after a multi-goal game yesterday. It was nice to see the secondary scoring contributing and the usual suspects back on the board today. Behind the net now, the puck goes where Cassandra Poudrier goes to retrieve it in the corner. Kim Deschain has it along the boards. Making away with it now is Poudrier, sends it forward for Lafour. Lafour skates through neutralized territory and into the offensive zone. As Montreal, Sarah loses her stick and skates back towards the bench. Brampton has the puck in front of Labonte, but that shot is just wide, glove side. With the puck now is Marie-Philippe Poulin. We're on hat trick watch in the first period for the captain. She's in Brampton territory, sends it to Anne-Sophie Bethea. Back along the boards where Carly Hill will retrieve the puck, or attempt to. Brampton does. Wraps it around behind their own net. Anne-Sophie Bethea skates into the corner. Carly Hill loses the blue line, and that one squeezes into Montreal territory, where Brittany Four Acres will settle the puck and clear the zone, where Brampton awaits, picking it up. But Poulin is there. She has Anne-Sophie Bethea as they skate into Montreal territory. In front, Liz Knox knocks away a shot. Puck bounces along the boards, but the line is held by Carly Hill this time. Behind the net, Kim Deschain bumping against Brampton's players. She had a tough go yesterday against Brampton as they got quite physical with Deschain. Brampton now has the puck in the offensive zone. Skates around, does Jess Jones. CWHL co-leading scorer this season with 37 points. Behind the net now, the puck goes into the corner where Emmanuel Blais will retrieve it, send it forward to the blue line to clear the zone, and Brampton is forced to get out and get back onside as they'll settle up things back along their own blue line, dump it into the offensive zone, and go for a change.
And a high stick making contact with the puck, so the faceoff will come back deep in Canadian territory to the left of Charlene Labonte. So Poulin with her second of the game, Ouellette with her second point of the game, an assist at 15-18 of this first period to make it 3-1. Now that's a big hole for Brampton to come back from, because they have had control of the puck in the offensive zone for, I'd say, a good 7 or 8 minutes of this first 18 minutes played in this hockey game, Robin, and they've created some scoring chances, but most of their shots have been coming from the perimeter. A couple of times they've been able to get players to the front of the goal in front of Labonte, but most of the shots are going up on the blocker side.
Katia Klimohedra trying to get a shot in on Liz Knox. She manages to do so as the puck squeezes through, but back out and into the corner where Julie Chu pinches in and dumps it in behind Liz Knox and skates back out towards the blue line. Brampton has it now, trying to get out of their own zone. As you mentioned, John, they've got quite a hole to dig themselves out of, and they've got just over 2 minutes left in the first period to start doing that. Puck goes in behind Labonte, where Kathy Chartrand picks it up, skates it into the corner. Along the boards for Carol Amard, who keeps control of the puck as she skates it into neutralized territory, where Sarah Lafour will dump it into Brampton territory. Ouellette now loses the puck at the center ice mark. Brampton dumps it in behind Labonte, who calms the puck for Poudrier, back into the corner for Poulin at the circle. She sends it through center ice where Anne-Sophie Bethea picks it up. She tries to grab the puck and to get a shot on Liz Knox, but loses it. She has her teammates with her who do manage to get a shot on Liz Knox, who almost loses the puck. She drops it with her glove and it almost squeezes over the goal line. Brampton clears the zone now. Poulin picks it up at center ice, dangles with the puck to send it up towards the Brampton bench where Anne-Sophie Bethea picks it up. Brampton now has control, sends it into Montreal territory, and they'll go for a change. Well, that's the first time this game that Marie-Philippe Poulin has made me laugh out loud with her skill, something that happens quite often when I'm watching her play.
Shannon McCauley was the player for Brampton that made the great back check on Anne-Sophie Bethea just moments before prior, who had a scoring chance almost come to fruition on her stick in the slot.
Battle for the puck along the boards right now. Brittany Four Acres is there along with Noemi Marin. As nobody seems to be able to get the puck loose, but it does squeeze free where Cassandra Poudrier sends it for Blais as she skates it out of her zone and into Brampton territory, collides with a Brampton player. And Brampton now gets it out of their zone through neutral ice, sends it all the way up front for Jess Jones, who gets the shot on Labonte, who effortlessly gets the glove up, making the save with 17.1 seconds left to play in the first period. It's a 3-1 hockey game here in Brossard. Reminder that during our first intermission, John Bauer will be speaking with Brampton point leader this season, Jess Jones. She's the co-winner of the Angela James Bowl trophy this season with Marie-Philippe Poulin, both scoring 37 points this season. And also during the broadcast this afternoon, we will be speaking with CWHL Commissioner Brenda Andrus. Brampton now takes a shot on Labonte. That one doesn't get through traffic, squeezes out along the boards. 8 seconds left to go in the first period. Brampton keeps it in. Poulin, though, gets control of the puck, and she'll hang on to it as time winds down in the first period. Bette clears the zone as the buzzer goes. 3-1 Montreal after 20 minutes of play in game two of the CWHL semifinals here at the Bell Sports Complex in Brossard, as everybody will skate off now for intermission. Standing by at ice level is John Bauer. He will be speaking with Jess Jones, wearing number 10 this afternoon. As you'll notice, the Brampton Thunder not wearing their regular jerseys today. They're wearing Brossard jerseys with different numbers for the most part. Jess Jones, not usually in number 10, but she is today. Becca King wearing 32, Jocelyn LaRock in 21, Laura Stacy is wearing 72, Laura Fortino is wearing 82. So it's a bit of a jumble this afternoon. We'll memorize these numbers for you during the next 15-minute intermission, and we'll be all set to go in the second period here at the Bell Sports Complex in Brossard. Game one yesterday, Montreal taking it by a score of 7-1. Secondary scoring was key in that game, as was special teams. Montreal capitalizing on 5 of their 11 power play opportunities. And this afternoon, they scored another power play goal as well as a shorthanded goal. Marie-Philippe Poulin, her first 2 goals of the playoffs this afternoon. She opened the scoring, assisted by Bette and Ouellette. Nancy Cuvette then scored shorthanded. Jess Jones got Brampton on the board, assisted by Jamie Lee Rattray, followed by a Poulin goal with Carolyn Ouellette getting the assist. So that's our scoring summary this afternoon. 3-1 for Montreal. Liz Knox in goal for the Brampton Thunder. Charlene Labonte playing her second straight game in 2 days. And a reminder that the Clarkson Cup final is next Sunday afternoon, 4 p.m. at the Canadian Tire Centre in Kanata, Ontario. Tickets are available on the CWHL website. You go to ECWHL.com to buy your tickets.
Up on the monitor on the right will be good.
For just $20. And now, looking down towards John Bauer as he stands by with Jess Jones, and we'll get ready to hand things off to John.
Thank you very much, Robin. Joined by Jess Jones. Jess, a bit of a rough start, getting down 2-0 so quickly. Was the team able to come back in that period and you scoring the goal?
Yeah, I mean, we got a couple bad bounces early on, but I think we're working hard and we're going to get pucks going our way soon.
So, Jess, this season, 37 points on the campaign. How would you describe your campaign personally, but also as a team?
Yeah, it's a great year so far for me and my team. I think everyone's playing well. Pucks are going in the net, which is nice to see. Hopefully we'll just come out and get a good win tonight.
So you're playing a best of three series all up here in Montreal. What are some of the challenges for a team that has to be on the road for potentially three games over a weekend as opposed to the normal 2-game weekend set?
Yeah, I mean, it's a challenge for sure, but being away, not on our home ice, having our fans, but it's nice to see some fans making the trip too. So we got that home atmosphere too. So, I mean, we make do, I think. It's a good battling game so far, so hopefully we'll pull out the win here.
And the Brampton Thunder fans are very, very passionate. They love their team, the way that you guys play, a physical style of hockey. What is it like to have such passionate fans following you either to the All-Star game or even up here to Montreal this weekend?
It's great. That's what it's all about. You know, we're about growing the game, and it's nice to have fans to come out to games like this. It's a good game to watch. It's a fun hockey. It's physical. A lot of things happen, so it's fun.
So, Jess, what do the Thunder have to do in the second and third period to come back in the game tonight?
Keep it simple. Little chips, keep shooting on her. You know, the puck's bouncing a little bit, and hopefully we'll get a few bouncing our way.
A lot of the shots were high to the blocker side on Labonte in that first period. Is that a strategy that the team is looking to try to exploit?
I mean, we're trying to shoot for a rebound, so we got to get him a little bit lower, but she's catching everything right now, so try to keep it away from her glove, and hopefully good things will happen.
Well, Jess Jones, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you very much.
Jess Jones, the leading scorer of the Brampton Thunder with 37 points in the regular season, and the lone goal scorer for Brampton here in the opening period is the Canadien lead 3-1. Robin, back up to you in the booth.
Thanks, John. And Jess, we are back up in the booth, standing by with Jared Book of Habs Eyes on the Prize. Momentarily, we will go over some of this year's award nominees, and that is coming up next right here on CWHL Live, powered by Hilberg and Burke, empowering female athletes.
Kimmy, you do know that there's only four seasons, right?
Then how do you explain the way kids wish away the summer because we can't wait to play in the fall? Or how teammates often become best mates? Or how families have a new vacation in Winnipeg in January because that's where the tournament is? So you see, Miss Woods, there is a fifth season, and it's the best season in Canada.
So you're talking about hockey?
Oh, it's more than just talking, Miss Woods.
Scotiabank is proud to support over 5,000 teams in Canada's fifth season.
Joignez-nous à Vive le sport féminin. Hey! 100% énergie. Hey! 100% passion. 100% effort. Pourtant, les femmes n'ont que 5% de visibilité. Les producteurs laitiers canadiens croient que les athlètes féminines devraient être vues et entendues haut et fort. Avec Nourrir la passion du sport féminin, nous célébrons les athlètes féminines de tous les niveaux. Joignez-nous à Vive le sport féminin.
Absolutely, it was a great start, 16 seconds into the game, and that's what Montreal needed. You knew that even though she got three assists yesterday, that she wasn't going to have another day where she wasn't going to score. And two goals in the first period, and Sophie Bate with a shorthanded goal as well. It's a good start for Montreal, for sure.
Also, interestingly, we're seeing that Brampton, again, special teams sort of being an issue for them. They had a power play opportunity today, and they squandered it, allowing Montreal to score a shorthanded goal. How hard do you think it is going to be for them to claw back into this game?
I feel they did a really good job going down 2-0. I feel that they really bounced back. They got that power play goal from Jess Jones, and I feel that that is really good for them as their season's on the line now. There's 40 minutes left. They're down by two, and this is going to be a telling sign in the second period what we're going to expect from Brampton.
So I mentioned that I wanted to talk a little bit about some of the award nominees this year, and I want to start with goalie of the year. Genevieve Lacasse, Charlene Labonte going for her third straight title, along with Christina Kessler of the Toronto Furies. Were you surprised by those nominations, Jared?
I was. Emerson Smashmeyer led the league in goals against average and in save percentage and was not nominated. So that was a little change that happened, but Genevieve Lacasse and Christina Kessler also had very good seasons. They're not bad goalies by any stretch of the imagination, but I feel that by numbers wise, Labonte has to be the favorite again. She had great numbers. She led them in 5 shutouts this year as well. Led the league in wins. That's going to be very tough to come. And she's the defending champion 2 times in a row. She's the favorite to make it 3, but who knows how the voting's going to go.
Also for Rookie of the Year, we saw Montreal's Katia Clément-Hadra nominated last year. This year, tonight at the rink, I think we saw who's going to be the winner. Laura Stacey has looked fantastic in this series and all season.
Yeah, absolutely. Laura Stacey for Brampton has been really good. Not take anything away from the other 2 nominees in terms of Ia Gavrilova and Renata Fast as well. They've been great too, but Laura Stacey led the league in rookie scoring, 2nd on a team in Brampton scoring, next to Jess Jones, who's nominated for MVP. So, I mean, it's Laura Stacey really came on the scene with this, and she was a first-round pick from Brampton. She was great this year.
What was also interesting was yesterday's playoff game between Brampton, or between Canada and Toronto, with Toronto coming away with a 5-2 win, Janelle Kohanchuk with a hat trick. I don't think anyone saw that coming. Last I checked, the game was tied 1-1. Did you see Toronto winning a game in that series?
No, I did not. I mean, Toronto only, I think, scored 6 goals all year against Calgary. They scored 5 yesterday against Emirates Maschmeyer, who we mentioned. It's a great showing for them, and it really put Calgary up against the 8-ball. They have not lost a playoff game in over 2 years now, so it'll be interesting to see how they respond today in Calgary. And so far, they were down 1-0 in that game. It's tied now, so it'll be very interesting, and it could be an exciting finish down the stretch there and here as well.
What do you expect to see from the rest of the game here this afternoon? Montreal leading 3-1 over the Brampton Thunder in game 2 of the semifinals.
Brampton's a desperate team. They have to win this game to extend their season, and they're a good team. So I think you'll see a lot of pushback like we saw when it was 2-0. They came back hard on Montreal, and I think that you'll see that again. They had scoring chances. It's not going to be easy for them to come back, but I feel that they're going to be desperate. And when you're a desperate team, there's not really a match for that. When your back's against the wall, there's no match that Montreal can have. They can say all they want, but there's a difference between actually having your back against the wall and playing like it. And Brampton's going to have a very important 40 minutes to go.
You can read Jared Book on Habs Eyes on the Prize and follow him on Twitter at Jared Book. And we'll send it back up to the booth, standing by for second period play here at the Bell Sports Complex in Brossard, where the Canadiens lead the Brampton Thunder 3-1.
Are we live? Action. Let's do it. Let's go. Let's get him. I couldn't imagine what I would do if I was these kids' age and something like this happened. Are we going right now?
Going.
All right, let's go. Burlington Eagle! You guys are something else. Okay, first of all, why am I here? This has nothing to do with what you do on the ice. This has to do with you guys being great individuals and doing something that's bigger than yourself, that's bigger than the game of hockey, right?
My coach is always telling me that nobody wins on their own. They always win as a team. Bye, Mom.
Hey, where's my kiss?
Bye.
All right, boys, we've dropped the bags off. Now we got to go pick them up. Okay, you guys all ready?
Put the hands in. 1, 3. 1, 2, 3. Eagles!
The Burlington Eagles raised the most food, not just in Burlington, but right across Canada.
All right, good luck. Nice job that you're doing.
Everybody put a lot of effort into getting the food.
As a parent, you put your kids in hockey because you really want them to develop some skills. But it's really incredible when you actually see your kids become compassionate.
You guys have inspired me so much. Thousands of pounds of food. You just don't play hockey to win, but to be better people. So Scotiabank and I are going to give you guys a crazy opportunity. We've selected 3 teams across Canada that are going to compete in a series of challenges. And guess what? You guys are one of them. What do you guys think? I'm actually going to be like your mentor. I'm going to help you guys win this opportunity to go. And the winner goes to Scotiabank Hockey Day in Canada.
Well, when I was born, that was probably the best thing in my life, but this was the second best thing.
That's what I'm talking about!
talking about. All right.
Okay, so three teams. You guys are one of them. Do you want to know who you're up against?
Let's go. Come on, guys.
All right, you guys ready? Let's do this.
Come on, guys.
I'm Darcy Tucker, and I'm going to be your host. Our first challenge is...
Que 5% de visibilité. Les producteurs laitiers canadiens croient que les athlètes féminines devraient être vues et entendues haut et fort. Avec Nourrir la passion du sport féminin, nous célébrons les athlètes féminines de tous les niveaux. Joignez-nous à Vive le sport féminin.
3-1, les Canadiens de Montréal lead the Brampton Thunder after 20 minutes of play in game 2 of their best of 3 CWHL semifinal series. Les Canadiens lead the series 1-0. The scoring summary in the first period, Marie-Philippe Poulin opens the scoring at 16 seconds of the opening 20. Her first goal of the postseason, Bette and Ouellette with the assist. Then Bette shorthanded at 4:50. Give Les Canadiens a 2-0 lead. Jess Jones from Jamie Lee Rattray at 6:23 makes it 2-1, cutting the lead in half. And then Poulin with her second of the game from Caroline Ouellette at 15:18 makes it 3-1 through 20 minutes of play. On the out-of-town scoreboard, the Calgary Inferno and the Toronto Furies are tied up at 1 apiece in game 2 of their best of 3 semifinal series, with Toronto having a 1-0 advantage after yesterday's victory in Cowtown. Natalie Spooner from Kelly Terry at 2:51 of the opening period started things in the hockey game. And then at 11:34, Haley Irwin, her first of the postseason from Caitlin Gosling, and Rebecca Johnston ties things up. Genevieve Lacasse has stopped 17 of 18 shots for Calgary, while Christina Kessler has turned aside 22 of 23 shots in the opening, first 31 minutes of the hockey game. They are midway through period number 2 out in Calgary. So we have a slight delay again here in this period because a bank of lights have shut out, have been turned off, or have gone off here at the Complexe Sportif Bell here in Brossard. I'm not sure whether or not we're going to attempt to play with a darkness over the middle part of the rink, but we may be in another delay such as what we had prior to the contest as we try to get the uniform situation straightened out between the two teams, as both teams were on the ice during the warm-up wearing their light uniforms. And finally, things got straightened out as Brampton is wearing Brassard black uniforms with red numbers on the back. Not ideal for broadcasters, to say the least, Robin, and especially with us getting lineups changed so late. Completely redone with numbers that we've never seen in women's hockey.
Yes. The only the constant is Jamie Lee Rattray. She continues to wear number 26 as she usually does in the season. And other ones that you're going to want to know, we won't run through them all with you. No need to do that. There's a few players you're going to want to know. Jess Jones is wearing 10. Laura Stacey is wearing 72, as we said. Jamie Lee Rattray still wearing her 26. Laura Fortino is in 82 instead of 8. Rebecca Vint, 38. Courtney Burchard, 14. So those are the players you're going to see on the ice the most in this hockey game. So those are the ones you're going to want to remember, and I am committing them to memory now as we speak.
You are a much better person than I am when it comes to memory, but then again, you're also, 15, 20 years younger than I am.
I thought you were going to say I'm 15. I was like, no, I've graduated high school. Thank you very much.
No, not that. Not quite that young, my friend.
No, I am young, though.
Yes, you are. Yes, you are.
Which I like.
Well, you know what?
You're young, too. It's all about how you feel, John.
That's true. That's true. Hey, look at Lisa Marie Bertrand Lebrun. You know, the coach. She's been playing high-level hockey for years. You know, around my age now, and she's got the energy of a 20-year-old. I see her every day as a strength and conditioning coach with the Concordia Stingers. And what's amazing with that is just seeing how much energy and pep she has every day. And it's translated over here with her being an assistant coach with Les Canadiennes OC as well. Sorry, as I switch between Fringlish.
I spoke to Lisa Marie Breton-Lebreux after practice on Thursday and asked her what the keys to the series were. And I already mentioned the fact that they faced more adversity than they normally did this year was a huge factor for them. But she also mentioned special teams, which has been huge in this series. 5 power play goals yesterday, a power play goal today for Montreal, as well as a shorthanded goal, which has been absolutely huge for them. And the other thing that she mentioned was speed, particularly against Brampton. Montreal's speed is something that has always been their forte, and Brampton is just not as fast as they are. And I've spoken in the past to Anne-Sophie Batte about how physical things get between Montreal and Brampton, and she said it's because they can't keep up with us. They have to hook and grab and claw to just keep up with us because we're just such a fast team.
Well, we in talking with Jess Jones in the intermission, you know, I asked her specifically about the fact that they're a tough team, that they're a fast, you know, that they grind out victories, and it's the identity of that team as well. And they're a hardworking squad, and they believe. She believes that they can come back in this hockey game, that they can come back and win this series. And they're inspired by their fans who have come up here to Montreal this weekend. They're all sitting down 2 hour left on the north end of the building here in Brossard. And you know what? It's a testament to see how solid these teams are. Because each team in the CWHL has its own identity.
Yeah.
You know, and that's what's great. It's not a cookie cutter league. Each team has a specialty. The Canadiens, if you get into a track meet with them, you're going to have difficulty.
Absolutely. They are the fastest team, bar none. If there was an all-star skills competition,
yes.
Anyone on the Canadiens roster could compete and win.
So you have that. Then you have Calgary, which is a very fundamentally sound two-way hockey team. They start on the back end, their blue line, therefore there's not a lot of weaknesses in that team. The Brampton Thunder, it is a team that will outwork you.
Yes.
They will go and battle hard along the boards, and as we saw in that first period, they were able to keep the puck in Montreal's territory for about 10 minutes of play because of their aggressive forecheck and their tenacity.
They're also a team that gets energized by a goal.
Oh, yes.
You know, they definitely, you can see a tangible switch in momentum. After Jess Jones scored that goal to cut Montreal's lead to 2-1 at the time, you could see they were pushing. It was sustained offensive zone pressure. They had the puck. Even if it chipped out into the center ice territory, they got it right back. They were pushing so, so hard. And that's something that they have to do after the opposition scores as well. You have to try and turn that momentum in your favor.
The Toronto Fury's identity, again, a hardworking team with a little bit more skill up front. You know, when you got Natalie Spooner, one of the best players in the world, on your team, and Cohen Chuck, who had a fantastic game last night, she's got a great set of hands. They have a very gifted offensive team, and their goaltending is very, very solid as well. Where they may have a little bit less of an advantage is maybe their blue line core. It's not as developed as some of the other teams in the league. And then Boston, as they come along, they're developing a very young team, a team that's hard-working, never gives up. They fight right to the finish. But they're a team that defensively, that's how they're going to win hockey games. Because they've got to keep the puck out of the back of their net. And when they do, they give themselves a chance to be in games.
One thing that was really fun to watch with the Boston Blades this season was the emergence of Lauren Dahm, who joined the team, and she had an extraordinary season. She was very well missed All-Star Weekend. A lot of the players remarking that she should have been there. She had a great year for Boston. It's hard to backstop that team because you are going to be facing a lot of rubber every single night, and she did it so well this year. I had the chance to speak with her on my show on TSN 690. And
what show was that, Robin?
Center Ice, Sunday mornings at 11 a.m.
And if people who aren't in this market wanted to listen to this outstanding show, which does focus a lot on women's hockey, how would they do that?
You go to tsn.ca. You just click over to Montreal's radio section, and you can listen online. Or old school, 690 on the dial.
Or new school, the iHeartRadio app.
That's true, the iHeartRadio app. I have it. You can listen to all the TSN radio stations. Shameless plug. But yes, when I was speaking with Lauren Dahm on my show a few weeks ago, I asked her, this was one of the most interesting answers a hockey player has ever given me. I asked her what kind of music she listens to. What do you have on your iPod, Lauren? She said, I like country music. So I said, oh, you know, that's interesting. Carey Price, goaltender for the Montreal Canadiens. Also, and why do you think it is that goalies are attracted to country music? And she said, the music really imitates the rhythm of the game. So she listens to country music to get into game mode, which was such a fascinating answer that I was not prepared for. I was expecting, I grew up listening to country, my parents were country fans. No, she listens to it because it imitates the rhythm of a hockey game.
That's fascinating as an answer. Wow.
You're gobsmacked, John.
I'm thinking about this because, you know, when I started in radio, it was at a classic country radio station down in Motown, in Detroit of all places, and that's where we started my hockey broadcasting career at the same station. But that is really interesting. I can understand where she's going with that answer. That is, wow. And folks, if you do get a chance, you should listen to Robin's show. It is fantastic. Because you're going to get a perspective on hockey that you're not going to get anywhere else. I'm biased. Robin's a friend of mine. She's my broadcast partner. I think very highly of her, and her work ethic and what she does is fantastic. And you should really try and tune into her show because it is, if you're a women's hockey fan, and we talk about both. We talk about both the NWHL as well as the CWHL, university hockey as well. As the lights, you can now see on the right-hand side of your screen that the lights are starting to warm up and light up. So hopefully we'll be able to get back underway very soon.
Yeah, if you're just joining us, there was a bit of a delay to start the second period as it looks like some of the lights went out. So it looks like they're going into backup mode. So we'll get some lights on here for you. We can't get started until we do have some lights on the ice.
Hey, let's hope that we don't have another delay in the third period.
So we've got a different roster for the Brampton Thunder. Same roster, different jerseys and different jersey numbers. So that was the delay to start the first. Now we have this lighting issue, delay to start the second period. If you are a betting person, I would say, what would be the next delay for the start of the third period, John?
With the torrential downpour outside?
Well, I saw some really great puns on Twitter that Brampton was bringing the thunder this afternoon as it is raining very, very hard in an abnormally warm day here in Brossard and in Montreal as well. It's 13 degrees this afternoon.
13 degrees. This is not winter, folks.
It really mimics playoff hockey when you've got spring-like temperatures outside, which is just perfect.
Well, and the humidity in the building today, that was something I noticed immediately when we walked into the building itself.
I wonder what effect that has on the ice when it's a little bit more humid. You always hear people talking about in the spring when it comes playoff time that the ice surface is a little bit more difficult to play on.
Well, actually, and I'm going to ask our camera guys if we can zoom in a little bit on the ice as we have.
Oh, but we can't go away from this adorable dancing child, John.
That's true. But if we can try and find some of the ruts in the ice, there is still water, and despite the fact that we've had about a 10-minute delay here, that's what happens. When there is humidity in the rink, it means that the ice doesn't freeze as quickly. And that's what we risk. And, of course, this is the rink that the Montreal Canadiens of the National Hockey League practice on every day as well. So there are ruts in the ice normally. And what happens is that when there's humidity, it just means that the ice is a little bit softer. The compressors are working harder to try and take the humidity out of the air so the ice can freeze. Conversely, when it's 30 below outside, the ice becomes brittle because it freezes too quickly. So the lights went on and they're back off now over the ice. So let's take a look at what's happening elsewhere in the CWHL this afternoon. Blair Turnbull from Jessica Campbell and Megan Mickelson at 13:21 of the second period has given Calgary a 2-1 lead in their second game of their semifinal series against the Toronto Furies. Toronto leads that series 1-0 after last night's opening game victory. So Calgary facing elimination. And they are currently looking at trying to work through this. Now, don't want to be an alarmist, Robin, but the trainers are bringing stuff off of the benches, and I do see the commissioner speaking with May Hewins right now to our right. So we may be in for a little bit longer delay. So, Matt Copeland, do we have something queued up that we can go to? In a few moments' time, a break here that we can maybe take while we get some more information? Okay, so we're going to take a quick timeout, and as soon as we can, we will come back with more information on what's going on here as we have a delay due to a lack of lighting in the arena. It's 3-1 Montreal after 20 minutes of play. Game two of their best of three semifinal series. This is CWHL Live.
Sanderson passes it to Westfall, takes a shot, and it's a no-goal.
Westfall passes it to Sanderson, who passes it to Bobby Orr.
Tried a shot that was wide and keen and cleared, but not out. Bobby Orr, behind the net to Sanderson, to Orr! Bobby Orr! The Boston Bruins!
Up the center, coming in as Lou, Gillendike centered it!
To play in the second. Here's Lemieux. His center penalty coming out. Look at Lemieux. Oh my goodness. What a goal. What a move. Lemieux. Oh, baby.
Here's a shot. Anderson made a wild stab work spell. Here's another shot. Right by the door. Anderson has scored to Canada.
And the crowd goes
Coach Dillon taught me to play hockey when I was 5. He tried to make him feel happier, but it's really hard since Jordan was also our friend, so we were all sad as well.
When I hit the ice with those kids, that was my safe place. That was the only place that felt right.
I wanted to make a difference, and I didn't want to see anyone else suffer through the same thing that I saw what Jordan suffered through. We decided as a team to cut our hair together.
Georgia, Georgia, Molly, Molly, yay!
He said, you know, Mom, it's for kids who go through chemotherapy because kids have cancer. And I mean, she saw that firsthand.
My hair looks kind of like a Christmas tree.
It speaks of the character of those kids. Some little girl somewhere will really appreciate that gesture.
This is the most unbelievable way to honor Jordan as a team. You girls have done something very special. And that's why you've been selected for a competition. If you girls win, you're going to Scotiabank Hockey Day in Canada. You girls gotta know, this competition is going to be tough.
Hey everyone, I'm gonna be your host. Inferno, you're up first.
Go, Cali, go!
Double check him!
The Calgary Inferno with less than a minute to go.
Welcome back into the Bell Sports Complex in Brossard, where Les Canadiens lead 3-1 after one period of play. Bit of a delay here at the Bell Sports Complex. We go now to ice level, where John Bauer is standing by with an update.
Thank you very much, Robin. So the delay, obvious as we know, has been caused by lights going out. The referees who are responsible under the Quebec law on sport for the security of everybody playing, they've been in conversation with the commissioner, as well as with Laurie Dupuis and Meg Hewins from Brampton and from Montreal, respectively. And it looks like we're going to get back underway here in just a few moments' time. The coaching staff for both teams have been addressed on this matter, and everybody feels that it's safe enough for the two teams to take the ice and to participate and to continue the hockey game right now. As I mentioned, there is a provincial law here in Quebec that does mandate that officials take control of any type of dangerous situation. A black puck, obviously, with shadows can be a challenge for the security of the players. However, everybody has been in discussions. The officials are back on the ice and will be getting set to drop the puck in about 3 or 4 minutes' time. Robin, back up to you.
Thank you, John. So as you heard, we will be getting started shortly. We see coaching staff for Montreal has made their way to the bench. The officials going for a little skate around the ice. The thing you have to remember with a delay like this is that it's difficult for the players who get a little bit cold. You know, you're probably going to see them go for a little bit of a skate, maybe do a quick warm-up before we get going with the second period here at the Bell Sports Complex, because it can be dangerous to be cold for this long and go out. So you imagine the players have been trying their best to keep warm in the dressing room, moving, stretching, trying to keep things going, and hopefully we will be able to get going here shortly, as I think the officials are doing a quick skate around to make sure also that the surface is safe enough for them to play on. And right now we have a referee speaking to the scorekeeper as everybody is hoping we can get going, which will happen now as we see Brampton skating out onto the ice as Liz Knox takes her spot in the goaler's crease as we're about to get underway now as the Thunder make their way onto the ice, and they will be followed shortly by Les Canadiens. Reminder that the Brampton Thunder not wearing their usual jerseys. If you're just joining us, they are wearing Brossard black and red jerseys trimmed in yellow and white, and they'll also be wearing different numbers this afternoon. Jess Jones wearing number 10, Laura Stacey 72, Jamie Lee Rattray, only one who keeps her number, 26. And John Bauer joins me back now in the booth as we're about to get started here with the second period.
They could have been coming back out onto the ice, but of course, as we noticed, there is some darkness on the ice, so that'll make it be even more of a challenge calling the dark uniforms and dark numbers as well here in this second period, as the second period is brought to you by
Hilberg and Burke. They are empowering female athletes. You'll notice everybody in the CWHL wearing these beautiful sparkle ball earrings.
Except for you and I.
Except for you and I. I think I need to get my hand on a pair of these because I saw Carolyn Ouellette wearing a purple pair the other day and they were just...
Weren't they stunning?
Oh, gorgeous. And you'll see Mary Philippe Lane wearing the white sparkle ball earrings. They're just absolutely gorgeous, and you can go get those on Hilberg and Burke's website. And I highly recommend you do, because I'll be getting a pair for myself soon.
What's really nice is, again, our sponsors who make this league possible and the different partnerships. And as we were discussing at the All-Star game a couple of weeks ago, the partnership with the NHLPA. I'll talk to Brenda about that coming up in the second intermission as well.
So we're all set to go finally here on the second period as Poulin lines up to take the draw. And Poulin wins it, sends it back into her own zone where Lauriane Rougeau sends it back for Poudrier through center ice where the puck trickles through, and Sophie Bette sends it back where Poudrier will skate into the corner to collect the puck, sending it around for Rougeau. Sends it forward for Ouellette, who skates it past her own blue line through neutral territory, dumping it into the corner for Brampton. Skating into the corner to retrieve it now was Anne-Sophie Bété. Brampton has control and gets it out of their zone, skating into Montreal territory. It's a two-on-two. Poudrier is there. Cross-ice pass, and that one is ruled offside.
Elsewhere in the CWHL, now through 40 minutes of play, Calgary looking to stave off elimination this evening. They lead the Toronto Furies by a score of 2-1 on goals by Haley Irwin and Blair Turnbull. Natalie Spooner has the lone marker for Toronto.
And Toronto won yesterday, so it looks like that game, that series could go three as a shot goes through on Labonte, who gets her pad up and kicks it up into the netting, causing a stoppage of play here at the Bell Sports Complex in Brossard. 19:23 to go in the second period.
Shots on goal in our game in the first period favored the Canadiens 11-10, and that actually is quite indicative of the pace of play in that first period, as Brampton did have a lot of time in the offensive zone, but a lot of the shots were from the perimeter, and as you heard Jess Jones say, they're just trying to get rebounds on Labonte right now as more and more lights come back on here at the complex.
Shannon McCauley won the draw for Brampton. In the corner now has it is Carol Amard. Sends it around behind Labonte, where Kathy Chartrand gets a stick on it. Up forward for Katia Clément-Hedra. And that one is iced up the ice surface and behind Liz Knox. And the faceoff will come back.
So not exactly the same pace to start the second period that we saw in the opening 20, where the Canadiens scored two goals in the first 4 minutes, but it was very much up and down, up and down. I think that the extended delay in the intermission may have something to do with the icings here starting period number two.
Yeah, I was just mentioning that after you gave us your update from ice level, John, that it's really hard with delays like that for the players to stay warm.
Almost Sarah, definitely.
Sarah Lafour loses her stick. Brampton has control, sends it on net. Charlene Labonte gets her blocker up to knock it out. And Laura Stacey knocks her into her own net, bowling for Labonte's, gives her a little tap on the shoulder. No harm done. Labonte looks just fine as the crowd starts to do the wave here in Brossard. And our very own Matt Copeland is joining in as well.
So Laura Stacey, the stoppage of play is actually on a hand pass as she gloved the puck down off of the shot from the point that was blockered aside by Labonte. Again, Brampton looking for the rebounds to try and create scoring chances against the veteran tender.
Anne-Sophie Bété skates it into the Brampton zone. She has Carolyn Ouellette in front of Liz Knox in the corner, sending it behind for Carolyn Ouellette. The puck squeezes free where Bété picks it up in the corner. She has Poulin with her, who bats the puck out of the air and grabs it, skating along the boards. And she loses the puck as Brampton grabs it and skates it out of their zone and dumps it into Montreal territory, where Four Acres controls it, sending it back to Carly Hill, up for Poulin, who skates into Brampton territory, over for Carolyn Ouellette on the near side. She goes, skates in behind Liz Knox with the puck, sends it back up for Four Acres at the blue line, who sends the shot in front, and that one is knocked away by Rebecca Vint as the puck goes forward for Charlene Labonte, and she leaves it for Carly Hill, who goes for a skate behind her own net. Carly Hill now sending it up for Emmanuel Blay. Noemi Marin carries it into the offensive zone as Kim Deschaine doing some good work to keep onside there. Noemi Marin falls behind Liz Knox. Cassandra Poudrier takes the shot in front, unable to get the shot through as that one is blocked in front by, is that Caitlin Tuga?
Actually, it's Dania Simmons.
Dania Simmons wearing number 85.
And she had lost her stick, Robin, and that's what created that opportunity. That's why Deschaine tried to make the pass through as opposed to maybe taking the shot herself.
Kim Deschaine now with the puck in the corner. She leaves it for Marais, who knocks it forward back for her. In front is Manuel Blay. She goes to take the shot. Kim Deschaine cannot grab the rebound as it trickles through the crease and out to the corner. Rougeau now at the point, to the circle for Kim Deschaine, who leaves it in front, but there's no one there. Rougeau pinches in to the circle, fires it on net, but that one goes up high over Liz Knox and back along the far side, where Katia Clément-Hedra sends it to the blue line for Poudrier. Poudrier to Rougeau. Rougeau fires it on Liz Knox. It gets down on her knees to make the save with her pads. Puck now in the corner, where Sarah Lafour sends it up for Cassandra Poudrier. Back to Rougeau. Rougeau fakes the shot, goes for Sarah Lafour, who tries to backhand it on net, and that one is wide. Poudrier dumps it into the corner for Katia Clément-Hedra. Puck wraps around behind Liz Knox and into the corner, where Carol Amard and Sarah Lafour are there to grab it. Brampton jumps in to try and get the puck, as that one is knocked free, where Julie Chu in the high slot gets the shot and doesn't get through. As that one bounces off, Carol Amard has it now, sends it back for Sarah LaFour, who dipsies and doodles with it. Along the boards, back up to the blue line for Julie Chu. Kathy Chartrand at the dot, takes the shot, and that one goes wide of Liz Knox, who's down in the butterfly position. Mary Philippe Poulet sends it back up to the blue line for Chu. Chartrand back to Poulet at the circle. Chu fires it, and that one is high and wide of Liz Knox. Montreal going in front. Poulet now skates it up around and sends it to Chu at the blue line. Back to Poulet and into the corner where Ouellette loses it temporarily before sending it back to Chu. Chu to Chartrand. Dumps it in front to Poulet, who sends it forward to Julie Chu, and that one isn't able to get through traffic. Carolyn Ouellette in the corner, trying to find a teammate who has a clear shot, as this line has been on the ice for quite a long time and is in dire need of a line change. Kathy Chartrand takes a slap shot on Liz Knox, and that one is stopped and locked as the whistle is blown. 15-16 to play in the second period.
Almost 2 minutes trapped in their own zone, and a couple of things that happened there for Brampton. Becca King had lost her stick. She was the second player on that defensive stand to lose her stick up against the board. So she had a couple of chances to clear the puck, but she had no way to get it up the board. So the Canadians were able to pressure. Montreal was able to get two line changes in during that possession in the offensive zone, because obviously it's the long change or the short change if you're in the offensive zone. And that is why Brampton had such difficult time in getting out of their own zone, getting a stoppage in play, and the Canadians looked like they were in a shooting gallery.
Brampton has control of the puck as they skate it out of their own zone through neutralized territory, and they dump it into Montreal territory where Brittany Foureker settles it down, goes for a skate behind Labonte. She stops, takes a look, goes for a skate in front, sends it forward for Blay, who knocks it forward intended for Kim Deschaine, but Brampton gets control of it. And now Caitlin Tuga is in the offensive zone in front of Charlene Labonte, hoping to grab that puck from Foureker, which she manages to do. She has it. Tries to get it back from Emmanuel Blay, who falls to the ice. Brampton maintains possession, gets a shot on Charlene Labonte, who kicks it away with the right pad. Brampton maintaining possession of the puck in the offensive zone, losing it now as Emmanuel Blay sends it to Kim Deschaine, who just cannot clear the zone. Noémie Marin will try to do that. She grabs the puck and goes for a skate.
Always dangerous to go cross ice up the middle in your defensive zone when you're being hemmed in by Brampton, and it was McCauley that intercepted the puck and forces Montreal back in deep again.
And Carly Hill going for a difficult play there with Laura Stacey, but manages to get the puck out, and they ice the puck. So the faceoff, oh, no icing called. Okay.
Just waved off to the last moment by the back official.
Alrighty then. Rougeau sends it in and on Liz Knox, who knocks it away with her stick.
And an offside, I think, is what's being called. A protracted, delayed offside being called against the Canadiens. That's why Brampton wants the faceoff to come back in Montreal territory, because they're saying that they had the opportunity to clear on a couple of occasions. That's what the referee is speaking with the lines people right now to determine whether or not it should be determined as an intentional offside. And that's what the Brampton bench is asking for as well.
Well, you see Tyler Fiennes is a much calmer man than he was last night after he saw so many missed opportunities for power plays for his squad. He was noticeably upset, shall we say. Puck now bounces in on Liz Knox, who knocks it away for her own defender, who dumps it up through neutralized territory and into Montreal's zone. Puck goes behind, icing waved off. Lauriane Rougeau goes for a skate behind, trying to grab the puck, but Brampton is there. Grabbing the puck now is Laura Stacey, sending it into the corner, where Poudrier knocks it forward for Carol Amard, who skates into the offensive zone. She's got Sarah LaFour. Snipe show, takes the shot, and that one is knocked away by Liz Knox. Carol Amard in front now for Katia Klimahedra. She gets the shot off, but that one is wide. And the whistle is blown, and it looks like, do we have a penalty here? No. Okay, just a line change.
Oh, the net's off the mooring, that's why, to the right of Liz Knox. But a great breakout there by Le Canadienne.
What a shot by snipe show Sarah LaFour.
LaFour takes a great pass from Amar just inside the blue line and cuts towards the goal, and she almost caught the crossbar in the post on the blocking side of Liz Knox, and that could have been a dagger in the heart of Brampton.
Brampton manages to clear their zone and knocks it forward and goes for a bit of a skating race with Julie Chu, who is awfully fast and is known for pinching in on the play offensively as she is a natural forward and has been playing defense with the Canadiens for the last few seasons. Carolyn Millette sends it forward for Anne-Sophie Bété. She skates into the offensive zone, manages to get past Brampton, goes to get the shot, goes for the wraparound, sends it in front where Carolyn Millette tries to backhand it in, but Liz Knox manages to get the glove down and on the puck. 12:34 to play in the second period, 3-1 Montreal.
And a holding penalty in behind the play being called by the MAC official, which will let the Canadiens go to their second power play of the hockey game. They are 0-1 on the advantage. And Brampton is 1-2 with the power play tonight. As going to sit down for two or less is Shannon McCauley.
Out on the ice for the power play for Montreal, Noémie Marin, Carol Amard, and Sarah Lafour up front. On the back end, Kathy Chartrand and Lauriane Rougeau. Brampton, though, managing to clear their zone. Rougeau sends it back for Chartrand, who skates around behind Labonte. Rougeau in the corner on the far side has control of the puck as Montreal resets. Lafour forward, where Carol Amard waits for her to cross into the offensive territory, knocks it into the corner. Noémie Marin behind the net with Sarah Lafour to help out to grab the puck. Carol Amard manages to get it loose in the corner. No one at the point. She sends it forward for Kathy Chartrand as Rougeau gets back and she grabs the pass from Chartrand. Chartrand rockets it from the blue line, but that one is blocked in front by Jess Jones.
And they want to be careful because Jones is playing between the two point players on this power play. If she gets a chance to get away on a breakaway, she could get Brampton back in the game.
Oh, Kathy Chartrand with a rocket that didn't get by, and Carol Amard with the rebound gets the shot off. Liz Knox is knocked over in front as a scuffle will ensue in front of Liz Knox.
And Lafour looked like she was going to come up and just take a swing at one of the Brampton players who I think is going to get a penalty. It should be Kristen Richards. I think she's getting a roughing call for having knocked down Amari in front of the net. So they can again go to a 5-on-3 power play. This is the second 5-on-3 situation of the hockey game. The previous was for Brampton, and the Canadiens scored shorthanded on that opportunity.
So 109 will be how long Montreal has to play at 5-on-3 with two Brampton players in the box right now. In the box for Brampton, you have number 33 this afternoon, who usually wears number 9. That's Kristen Richards. And with her right now is Shannon McCauley, both serving penalties. Montreal now has it. Poulin up in the high slot, sends it to the circle for Carolyn Millette. Millette to Poulin. Poulin back for Julie Chu. Chu at the circle, grabs it, takes a look. Poulin with the one-timer. That one doesn't get through traffic. Poulin tries to get it through. Chu is there in front. Kim Deschaine isn't able to do it. Chu falling onto the ice, gets it, sends it forward for Millette to Poulin, and in front. That puck is knocked loose, but Carolyn Millette holds it in, sends it to Poulin for Anne-Sophie Bété, who one-times it and doesn't manage to beat Liz Knox. Goes for a skate behind to Julie Chu, who sends it to 29. Marie-Philippe Poulin back to Chu with the circle. And the net is knocked loose yet again.
Yeah, Bété caught it as she was trying to go behind the net. She and Knox kind of got tangled up a little bit, knocked the net off to the right of Knox.
So if you're just joining us this afternoon, you'll notice it's a little bit darker than usual here at the Bell Sports Complex in Brossard. There's with some lighting difficulties.
And you'll also notice that Brampton is wearing a strange color today in black, red, and gold for Brossard because of a bit of an issue with the jerseys tonight.
So bear with us as we are still learning their New Jersey numbers.
But the big one is Jess Jones is out there on this penalty kill, and she is a sniper. If they can kill this two-player advantage off, that would be huge for them.
Chu sends it to Carolyn Millette, back in the high slot for Marie-Philippe Poulin. Back to Millette. They go to change spots. Poulin at the circle, Chu at the other circle. Sends it in front for Poulin, who fakes the shot, doesn't manage to get it off. Chu back in the corner, sends it in front for Carolyn Millette, who one-times it on Liz Knox, who falls to make an impressive save as Brampton clears the zone. As there's 5-4-3-2-1 second remaining on the 5-on-3. Montreal now headed to a 5-on-4 power play. Brampton is just throwing their bodies on the ice here to block absolutely every shot they can.
That was Bierschaar, who just came out of the penalty box.
Carolyn Millette sends it to the blue line for Kathy Chartrand along the boards. Sends it back behind Liz Knox, where it wraps around to Clément Hadra. She sends it up for Rougeau, back to Clément Hadra. She kicks it away with her stick, or with her skate rather, as the puck is cleared by Shannon McCauley.
So Robin, 20 seconds left in the power play, and Les Canadiens have had good puck possession in the offensive zone, scoring chances, and Liz Knox made an outstanding glove save just moments ago.
Clem Alejandra to Rougeau, who takes the shot on Liz Knox, who gets up, loses it, drops down to the ice, but she gets her glove on it. A whistle is blown. 3 seconds left on the power play for Montreal.
It's interesting, Robin, when she went down to the butterfly, she actually didn't get her glove on it. The puck was laying right at between the two pads, and sniffing around there was Noémie Marin trying to get her stick on it just to tip the puck between the wickets in the back of the cage to give Les Canadiens a 4-1 lead. Knox has been outstanding in this hockey game despite giving up three goals, especially on this two-player advantage.
Brampton wins the draw, knocks it into the corner, where it's knocked out by Emmanuel Blais in front for Lafour, who gets the shot off, and that one is knocked up into the netting.
And Sarah Lafour is having a good second period, getting some scoring chances as well. That last one there, she probably had another second or two to maybe stride towards the goal before she tried to wrist that into the back of the cage, as Knox sneaks out the left pad, to tip the puck up out of play here with 9:38 to go. So we're midway through the hockey game, and the Canadiens up 3-1 on elimination night, potentially.
Brampton now on a breakaway is Laura Stacey, sends the puck, but that one is wide of Labonte, who was down and ready for it. In any case, Brampton keeps it into the zone. I spoke too soon. That one is out and ruled offside as it's knocked back in.
Laura Stacey read that face-off win by Les Canadiens perfectly. The puck was won back to the line, but between the time that the puck hit the ice and was back towards the blue line, she had pounced on the puck already and was taking it back the other way for the Thunder.
Vint lines up with Poulin. Poulin said during All-Star Weekend, the player she despises playing against is Rebecca Vint because she is so tough to play.
Let's see. Good chuckle over that answer.
Oh, Poulin, one-on-one. Sends it to Bete, who fires it, but that one is wide. And the puck is cleared into Montreal territory. With it now is Jamie Lee Rattray. She sends it in front for Rebecca Vint, who isn't able to get her stick on it. Poulin retrieves the puck in the corner, knocks it forward for Brittany Fouracres, as Montreal will go off for a change. Bete dumps it into the offensive zone, but she goes to switch up as well. Clément Hadra in Brampton territory. Carol Mart has it now. She loses control of the puck. Brampton picks it up and knocked over is Shannon McCauley.
On the out-of-town scoreboard, Robin, the Calgary Inferno facing elimination today, and they have now taken a 3-1 lead against the Toronto Furies. Ayla Gavrilova with her second of the postseason from Megan Mickelson and Brianne Jenner at 5:16 of the third period, giving the defending Clarkson Cup champions a two-goal advantage in the third period in their second game of their series.
Oh, we've got a penalty called on the ice, this time against Montreal. Looks like Brampton will head to the power play.
And as our producer, Matt Copeland, is reminding us that if you're interested in seeing that game, you can open up another window and see it on the alternate stream this evening as a big house, a full house out in Calgary, as well as here in Montreal today for the two teams. So Katia Clément-Hydra gets the gate here. And Brampton looking to score their second goal on the power play on the game. Jess Jones with the only one so far.
Brampton winning the faceoff with a rocket from the blue line from Courtney Burchard. Brampton has control of the puck on their power play. They scored on their last power play in this game. Burchard now sending it forward. With the puck is Laura Fortino. Back for Burchard. Burchard fakes the shot. That one is sent in front of Labonte by Rebecca Vint. Puck goes in behind Labonte. Going for a little bit of a skate now is Jamie Lee Rattray. Laura Fortino back for Burchard, who one-times it. That one knocked away by the pad of Labonte. Bit of a scrum in front. Lost sight of the puck. That one goes behind. Thought Charlie had it for a moment there as Montreal manages to clear the zone.
Brampton was trying to tuck it in on the short side. They might have been better off to have been playing it back to the point because with everybody collapsed down on top of Labonte and Labonte on all fours in the crease searching for the puck, they may have had a better opportunity to go upstairs.
Brampton resets. carries the puck in through neutral territory and into Montreal's zone. Dumps it into the corner, but it is offside. And just a reminder that John will be joined in the second intermission by Montreal captain Marie-Philippe Poulin, who has 2 goals in this afternoon's hockey game. It's a 3-1 game in favor of Montreal.
As well as the commissioner of the Ligue Grande, Andres, will be with me down rinkside in the second intermission.
Carol Lamard lines up for the draw as they kind of battle for that one. No clear winner on the faceoff, but they're still hacking away at it. And it kind of squeaks out sideways. Bate picks it up and carries it into the Brampton zone shorthanded. She did score a shorthanded goal this afternoon. In the corner now. And out. The puck squeezes out at the blue line. Carly Hill will dump it in as everybody gets out of Brampton zone to get back on side. And Montreal goes for partial line change. In the corner now is Carol Lamard trying to get the puck from Brampton. Brampton has it, dumps it into Montreal territory. Laura Stacey sends the puck in on Labonte, who makes the glove save. A double catch, and the whistle is blown.
So 12 seconds left on the power play. Brampton creating some scoring chances. A player down in the corner to the left, or to the right of Charlene Labonte. That is, there's a three. Is that Kristen Richards?
That's Shannon McCauley.
Oh, Shannon McCauley, number three. It is just number three, and it's supposed to 33.
The trainer was making her way out, but she gets up and skates towards the bench, and the trainer will return to the bench.
So, Robin, a reminder that this is game two of a best-of-three series. Like Canadian leading 1-0. On the other bracket, it's 1-0 Toronto in that series. So if Calgary were to tie things up today, there would be a third game tomorrow afternoon. And if Brampton comes back in this game and forces game number three, we'll be back here at the Complex Sports Bell tomorrow afternoon for a 1:30 puck drop here on CWHL Live.
And lining up for the faceoff now is Marie-Philippe Poulin. She's been good in the circle this afternoon. Rebecca Vint matched up against her. Poulin wins the draw, sends it back for Rougeau, who fires it out of Montreal territory. 5 seconds left on the penalty to Katia Clément-Hedra, who is anxiously awaiting jumping back on out onto the ice, and she does, rejoins the play. Puck goes into Montreal territory. In the corner is 4 acres. Loses control of the puck. Brampton grabs it. Some confusion there as Ouellette manages to get it through and knock it through to center ice. She tries to get control of the puck so she can get an offensive opportunity. Isn't able to do so. Collision at center ice. Marie-Philippe Poulin and Jamie Lee Rattray. Puck goes behind Liz Knox. Plays it off the boards on the far side. With the puck now is Bete. Sends it to the line for Chartrand, who can't hold the blue line. That one is knocked out. Montreal will reset. Bete has it. She goes in on Liz Knox. Top corner, glove save. 5:35 to go in the second period.
And I know that Anso is one of your favorite players of all time. She's a speedster, and I've known her since she was about 20 years of age. You knew her before when you were in CJEP.
That's right.
And I got to know her when she started playing for the McGill Martlets. But what a talented hockey player and outstanding human being off of the ice.
Nice to see her get a nomination for the Jaina Hefford Trophy this year. That's the MVP as voted by teammates.
Well, I know that you would be voting for her, and I actually, when I saw her nomination for the award, I thought the same thing, that now she has a very legit chance of winning that award this year.
She's very well respected in the CWHL, and that was made very clear at the All-Star Weekend.
She's very well respected around the league, that's for certain.
Brampton has it now in the offensive zone, trying to get a puck in on Labonte. That one goes up high and around into the corner where Kim Deschene battles along the boards, trying to send it forward for Marin into neutralized territory. Getting the puck loose is Marin into the offensive zone. Blay goes for escape. Deschene at the blue line. Chartrand now at center ice. Tips it up and into the Brampton near corner. Picking up the puck now and sending it back into Montreal's territory. Brampton battling along the boards with Montreal. Katia Clément-Hedra knocks it out and into center ice where Sarah Lafour goes to grab it. Isn't able to do so. Brampton grabs control of the puck and skates it back into Montreal territory where Montreal grabs it and knocks it back out. A lot of neutral zone territory play in the second period this afternoon in a 3-1 hockey game. Just over 4 minutes to play in the second period with a collision in the corner as a Brampton player is knocked down. Rebecca Vint to the ice. Puck in front. Katia Clément-Hedra knocked down by Vint as Liz Knox drops to her knees to make the save.
Everybody forgot that Katia was behind the net. She was in the trapezoid that we don't use in the CWHL, but she was there and just snuck out as the puck came off of the pads of Liz Knox. She was fighting for the puck in front, and Vint did a good job to get back in place to ensure that it was not tucked into the back of the cage to make it a three-goal advantage for Les Canadiens.
Poulin wins the draw, sends it back for Poudre at the blue line. She knocks it into the corner, back for Bette to Poulin. Skates it over to the far wall. Knocks it in behind Liz Knox, where Ouellette tips it to Bette. Back behind for Poulin, who will send it back around Liz Knox, carrying it behind her and into the corner, up to the blue line for Poudrier. Cassandra Poudrier tries to get the shot through, and that one is blocked by Jamie Lee Rattray.
And the net's off again.
It's that same net that keeps getting knocked off.
Apparently we are not using the breakaway pegs and just magnets down at that end of the rink.
So we thank you so much for spending your Saturday evening with us on CWHL Live, empowered by Hilberg and Burke, who empower female athletes and champion women's sports.
And as we mentioned a few minutes ago, if necessary, game three tomorrow afternoon here from the Bell Complex in Brossard, a 1:30 puck drop, and we will be back on the air. With under 10 minutes to go out in Calgary, it looks like that series is going to a third and decisive game as Calgary has a 3-1 lead on Toronto.
Brampton manages to clear the zone. Kathy Chartrand skates it up with Julie Chu, who goes behind Charlene Labonte, wraps it up around the net and up forward for Marin. Marin to Blaise. She skates into Brampton territory, around the corner where she dumps it in behind the net. Marin is there to grab it, to knock it in front, where Kim Deshane tries to grab it in the slot. Isn't able to do so as Brampton skates it out of their own zone through center ice territory, where Blaise gets control of the puck, sends it back for Chartrand, back to Chu, back to Chartrand, as they'll skate out of Montreal's zone. Puck knocked into the corner, where Liz Knox will knock it away for Dania Simmons. Oh, sorry, Taylor Woods, I should say. Back behind Charlene Labonte. Brampton trying to get a shot off, unable to do so. Carly Hill in the corner, grabs the puck, knocks it forward for Katia Clément-Hadra. Clément-Hadra skating forward out of Montreal's zone. Sarah LaFord tips it in front for Kara Lamard. She's got the puck. Tries to back pass it to Sarah LaFour, who is tripped up by Courtney Burchard, unable to get control of the puck. Brampton now getting the shot in on Charlene Labonte. She falls, doesn't see the puck. LaFour has it in front. Burchard takes another shot. Charlie is down, doesn't have her stick. Back in the corner, Clément-Hadra battling with Brampton. Charlene Labonte still doesn't have her stick. There she goes, picking it up right now. There's some debris in front of her as Montreal is having some difficulty clearing their zone. Brampton maintaining possession of the puck. Going in on Charlie, that one is high and wide. A shot by Laura Fortino.
Very similar to when Montreal trapped Brampton in their defensive zone earlier this period. Les Canadiens unable to get a line change here. Brampton's changed things up twice now.
Puck in front. Laura Fortino gets a shot in. That one blocked by Katia Clément-Hadra, sacrificing her body in front of her netminder. Puck in the corner, back up to the blue line. A rocket fired through, tipped away by Sarah LaFord. Kayla Mart gets possession of the puck and sends it front for Katia Clément-Hadra, who will dump it in as Montreal can finally go for a line change.
And very similar to the what started this all was the turnover in the offensive zone by that line.
And Sophie Bette has it, sends it in front for Marie-Philippe Poulin, who she loses the puck in the corner. Knocks it in front for Bette, who has Ouellette there, who tries to get something going, unable to do so as the puck trickles out and back into Montreal territory.
So where Brampton had the pressure for all that time, it all started on that turnover on the scoring chance with the pass left to right in the offensive zone.
Bette in front for Ouellette. She fans on the shot. Rougeau's there to pick it up, though, to send it back in front, but there's Brampton bodies everywhere as we approach the final minute of play in the second period.
So on that play, that was the one where Imar made the pass from the right side to the left side for LaFour, and then LaFour tried to go either back to Imar or across to Katia Clément-Hadra, and it was broken up right in the middle of the slot, and Brampton was able to counterattack on a 3-on-2 as a timeout's being called now by Brampton. And what happened there, Robin, is that those players, they fought back, they got back in the defensive zone, but unfortunately for them, what happened was is that they just couldn't get the puck out. Charlie made a couple of big saves, and then the players had to start diving all over the ice to try and keep the puck out of the back of the net, which they were successful in doing, but it allowed Brampton to get a couple of line changes out there and to maintain pressure in the offensive zone for a substantial period of time.
So we've got a timeout with 58.4 seconds left to play in the second period. Montreal still leading 3-1, which is also the score in the other game in progress right now. Calgary leading Toronto by a score of 3-1 with 4:50 left to play in the third period. If Calgary maintains that lead, that game will go to a third and decisive final semifinal game tomorrow afternoon on CWHL Live, which you can watch as well. You should be watching both games right now, Montreal, Brampton, Calgary, and Toronto, as Poulin lines up for the draw to the right of Liz Knox. Montreal wins it. Carolyn Ouellette trying to put it in front. Back for Kathy Chartrand into the corner where Ouellette picks it up. Knocks it forward for Poulin as Brampton tries to clear the zone. Poulin has it, sends it back up for Julie Chu at the blue line. Chu goes in front, tries to get a shot off, isn't able to do so. Blocked in front by bodies. Ouellette behind the net, knocking it through for Bette. Brampton grabs the puck, skates it out of their zone. 34 seconds left to play in the second period. Into Montreal territory where Poulin grabs it, knocks it to Ouellette. Ouellette back for Bette, who gets the shot through, isn't able to get it on Liz Knox, though. Brampton has control of the puck. 20 seconds left to play in the second period. Skates it out of their own zone as Montreal goes for a change. Rebecca Vint with the puck now, skating in, trying to get the shot through. That one knocked away by Julie Chu. Julie Chu in the corner has the puck, trying to clear Montreal territory. 6 seconds left to play in the second period as the battle ensues along the boards for the puck, as time will expire here in the second period at the Bell Sports Complex in Brossard, Quebec. Les Canadiens de Montréal leading by a score of 3-1 after a scoreless second period. Brampton, one on the board, a power play goal by Jess Jones, assisted by Jamie Lee Rattray in the first period. Your goal scorers for Montreal, Marie-Philippe Poulin with a pair, her first one assisted by Anne-Sophie Bette and Carolyn Ouellette, as well as Anne-Sophie Bette, a shorthanded, unassisted goal in the first period. As I mentioned, scoreless in the second period, as Brampton will have to try and get a few behind Charlene Labonte if they want to keep their playoff hopes alive. Montreal wins this afternoon. That means the series is over, and the Canadiens would punch their ticket to the Clarkson Cup final for the third straight year. But we mustn't get ahead of ourselves, as there's still 20 minutes left to play here in the semifinal at the Bell Sports Complex in Brossard, as the crowd cheers as their Canadiens head off the ice and towards their locker room. John Bauer standing by at ice level. He will be speaking with Montreal captain Marie-Philippe Poulin during the second intermission. And a little bit after that, he'll be joined by CWHL Commissioner Brenda Andrus, who is in the house this afternoon for Game 2, the semifinals between Montreal and Brampton. We thank you so much for joining us this afternoon. We appreciate your patience through all the delays. One for different jerseys. As you'll notice, Brampton wearing black, red, and gold jerseys with Brossard on them. And you'll notice it's also a little bit darker here this afternoon. And of course, all of this made possible by Hilberg and Burke, who empower this broadcast, and they empower women's sports. Sometimes the most entertaining things to happen are what you see on the ice between the action. But also entertaining is seeing John Bauer speaking with Montreal captain Marie-Philippe Poulin. We'll head down now to ice level, where John is joined by the captain.
By the captain, Marie-Philippe Poulin. The second period, very odd start to the period. How did the team stay focused during that delay?
Well, it was a little long in the dressing room for sure, but we knew we're going to face adversity for sure. We knew Brampton is a good team, and we had to come out a lot with a lot of speed, so that's what we did. And we know the legs were a little heavy at first, but we kept it short, we kept it intense, and put a lot of shot on the net.
In the first period, you came out strong. 16 seconds into the game, can you describe the goal for us?
Yeah, I mean, that was a great play again by Caro and Enzo. I mean, they make me look good out there. So they made a great pass, Enzo made it to me, and lucky enough, I was in a mini break away, and it went in. So it was a good start for sure, but there's a big 20 minutes coming up, and we got to keep going.
So what do the Canadiens have to do in this third period to win the game and take the series?
We're going to have to keep the pressure on for sure, play physical. We know they're pretty physical, and for us to put a lot of pressure on them, but play disciplined for sure. We're going to have to put pucks on net, make easy plays, and just put the puck on the net and play intense.
I know that you have a lot of high-level experience in clinching games and big games, but how tempting is it to maybe look forward to that next step next weekend?
For sure, but I mean, for us, we really go period by period, game by game, and right now it's not over, and we know they're going to come out hard, and we got to focus on that 20 minutes, because maybe last year we got caught in that, and we lost in that final. But we want to make sure we get ready, and we focus that 20 minutes.
Marie-Philippe Poulin, thank you very much for this, and good luck in the third period.
Thank you so much.
Marie-Philippe Poulin with a pair of goals in tonight's hockey game as the Canadiens lead 3-1 after 40 minutes of play. When we come back, Brenda Andres, the commissioner of the CWHL. This is CWHLLive.com.
As John mentioned, this is indeed CWHL Live. You are watching us on YouTube, empowered by Hilberg and Burke. Standing by at ice level is my broadcast partner, John Bauer, with CWHL Commissioner Brenda Andres. We go now to ice level, where John is standing by with Brenda.
Again, Robin, we're back down ringside with the Commissioner Brenda Andres of the CWHL. Brenda, a bit of a strange game today. What was the discussion that happened in that first intermission about the lights going out? What were some of the discussions between the officials, the league staff, and the coaching staff before we made the decision to go back out on the ice?
Well, the number one for the Canadian Women's Hockey League is to make sure our players are safe. And so we had the discussions with the officials and the general managers and the coaches to ensure that. The decision was made, we went back on, and miraculously the lights came back on with us, so it all worked out perfect.
It's been a great playoff so far. We saw last night Toronto taking the opening game of their series against Calgary. Calgary up late in the third period this afternoon, going three games. Highly competitive game this afternoon. What is your thought on the playoffs to this point?
Well, I think it depicts what our league is all about, is the closeness of all these games and the skill of those players within the game. And it really what I think the CWHL is proudest of is the players are all in parity, which is what we try to do with our league. And the competition is outstanding. You know, every time you see them, whether it's, on the Dream Game today out with Calgary and Toronto or here, it's just unbelievable how skilled these players are and how dedicated they are to this game.
And another great crowd here in Montreal and Calgary today, a full house. The league is really moving forward. How many tickets have been sold for the Clarkson Cup next Sunday? We've been encouraging people to go out there. How are things going with the preparation for the big championship next weekend?
Well, you know, the ticket sales is going good. We can always use a push, so thank you very much, John. But I think a lot will happen on what happens, which teams get in. You know, if the Les Canadiens get in here, then, a lot of fans come from Montreal to Ottawa and, again, from Toronto or Calgary. So we're on the wait and see. Great opportunity for anybody, in Ottawa and surrounding to see the best hockey there is. And, for the Clarkson Cup final, I hope that everybody takes a moment of time to come out and support our women. Their passion is phenomenal, and it's a great opportunity in your own backyard.
$20 are the tickets, and we're coming off a very successful All-Star game a few weeks ago in Toronto with a record crowd again. The league is really going in the right direction when it comes to getting more and more fan support. But one of the interesting announcements that came out of the All-Star weekend was the new partnership with the NHLPA. So we have a partnership with NHL teams, with the Players Association. How do you see the next several years for the CWHL rolling out?
Well, I think the NHL partnerships have been absolutely outstanding. When you see our games in Toronto, in the MLSE, in the stadium there, and at the Bell Center, and then you look after that of the fans. Same what the Calgary Flames do for us. It really supports the growth of not just women's hockey, but all of hockey. And that's really what these partnerships are about, is to support the grassroots game for both men and women, to make sure that our fans get to see the best game of hockey and to keep the game of hockey growing in North America. So it's a great partnership with our NHL teams, and the NHLPA is about making sure our players, with their research, to again the safety to for our players moving forward. And it's something we're very proud of. It's not just about, you know, the game itself. We do a lot of concussions. We did mental health this year with our players. You know, we're always there to make sure that it's just not about the game, but it's the safety of the game for our players. And our board is very proud of that and how they, you know, strategically make the moves moving forward, and so am I.
Well, Brenda, thank you very much for your leadership and for everything and your support here with our broadcast every year. We look forward to seeing you next week in Ottawa at the Clarkson Cup.
Thanks, John.
We'll be back in just a moment. 3-1.
Are we live? Action. Let's do it. Let's go. Let's get him. I couldn't imagine what I would do if I was these kids' age and something like this happened. Are we going right now?
Going.
All right, let's go. Burlington Eagle! You guys are something else. Okay, first of all, why am I here? This has nothing to do with what you do on the ice. This has to do with you guys being great individuals and doing something that's bigger than yourself, that's bigger than the game of hockey, right?
My coach is always telling me that nobody wins on their own. They always win as a team. Bye, Mom.
Hey, where's my kiss?
Bye.
All right, boys, we've dropped the bags off. Now we got to go pick them up. Okay, you guys all ready?
Put the hands in. One, three. One, two, three. Eagles!
The Burlington Eagles raised the most food, not just in Burlington, but right across Canada.
All right, good luck. Nice job that you're doing.
Everybody put a lot of effort into getting the food.
As a parent, you put your kids in hockey because you really want them to develop some skills. But it's really incredible when you actually see your kids become compassionate.
You guys have inspired me so much. Thousands of pounds of food. You just don't play hockey to win, but to be better people. So Scotiabank and I are going to give you guys a crazy opportunity. We've selected three teams across Canada that are going to compete in a series of challenges. And guess what? You guys are one of them. What do you guys think? What do you guys think? I'm actually going to be like your mentor. I'm going to help you guys win this opportunity to go. And the winner goes to Scotiabank Hockey Day in Canada.
Well, when I was born, that was probably the best thing in my life, but this was the second best thing.
Okay, so three teams, you guys are one of them. Do you want to know who you're up against?
Let's go. Come on, guys.
All right, you guys ready? Let's do this.
Come on, guys.
Hey!
I'm Darcy Tucker, and I'm going to be your host. Our first challenge is...
Trying something new.
100% énergie. 100% passion. 100% effort. Pourtant, les femmes n'ont que 5% de visibilité. Les producteurs laitiers canadiens croient que les athlètes féminines devraient être vues et entendues haut et fort. Avec Nourrir la passion du sport féminin, nous célébrons les athlètes féminines de tous les niveaux. Joignez-nous à Vive le sport féminin.
Sanderson passes it to Westfall, takes a shot, and it's a no-goal. Westfall passes it to Sanderson, who passes it to Bobby Orr.
Tried a shot that was wide and keen and cleared it, but not out. Bobby Orr, behind the net to Sanderson, to Orr! Bobby Orr! For the Boston Bruins!
Up to center, coming in as Lou, Gillendike centered it!
To play in the second. Here's Lemieux. The center penalty coming out. Look at Lemieux. Oh my heavens. What a goal. What a move. Lemieux. Oh, baby.
Here's their shot. Anderson made a wild stab work spell. Here's another shot. Right by the score. Anderson has scored the Canada.
And the crowd goes wild. Welcome
back inside the Bell Sports Complex in Brossard. We're just over 2 minutes away from the start of the third period here, where Les Canadiens have a 3-1 lead on the Brampton Thunder after 40 minutes of play in game two of their best of three semifinal series. If this score holds up, Montreal will be punching their ticket to the Clarkson Cup final for the third straight year, something that is extremely impressive from a team that is already the winningest team in CWHL history. CWHL, of course, celebrating their 10th anniversary this season, which is pretty impressive.
And our 10th season is brought to you in part by Hilberg & Burke, empowering women.
As Brampton makes their way back out onto the ice, if you're just joining us, you'll notice those are not the Brampton Thunder's usual jerseys. They are wearing the Brossard Stars jerseys, black and red with gold trim this afternoon. And yes, their numbers are not the same either. Jamie Lee Rattray is wearing 26. Everybody else is all jumbled up, though. Luckily for you, though, if you're a Canadien fan, they're wearing their normal jerseys with their normal numbers, so no confusion there.
Elsewhere in the CWHL Clarkson Cup playoffs this afternoon, the Calgary Inferno stave off elimination with a 3-1 win over the Toronto Furies out in Calgary. Calgary out shooting Toronto 40-29 in the game. Natalie Spooner got Toronto on the board at 2:45 of the first period. Haley Irwin replied to even things up at 1 at 11:34 of the stanza. Then Blair Turnbull with the game-winning goal at 13:21 of the second period. And Aya Gavrilova with the clincher, not the game-winning goal, but the goal that put it away in the third period at 5:16. Megan Mickelson picks up a pair of assists in the hockey game as Geneviève Lacasse turns aside 29 shots. Christina Kessler makes 37 saves in the loss.
That's John Bauer, and I am Robin Flynn, and this is CWHL Live Hockey. We thank you so much for spending your Saturday evening with us as Marie-Philippe Poulin wins the opening draw of the third period, and we are underway here at the Bell Sports Complex in Brossard with third period hockey. Marie-Philippe Poulin skates it into the offensive zone. Brampton picks it up, carrying it through neutralized territory as Laura Stacey all the way into Canadien territory, sends it in front for Courtney Burchard, isn't able to get her stick on it. Poulin sends it forward for Bette, who skates into Brampton territory up over the blue line. She has no one with her, so she has nobody to pass to on a one-on-three. Knocks it into the corner, or Brampton picks it up. Laura Stacey now battling with LaFour for the puck. She gets free and is tripped up along the boards with Jocelyn LaRocque. In the corner now is Rebecca Vint battling with LaFour. With Clément Hadra for the puck in front for Carol Lamarde, who tries to get a shot off on Liz Knox. That one up high and wide into the corner. Back to the blue line for Julie Chu. Sends it into the corner, banks it off for Katia Clément Hadra, who grabs the puck, tries to settle it down. But Brampton knocks it forward. Clément Hadra comes away with it, tries to put it in front for Sarah LaFord. She had her back turned to the play, and Brampton clears the zone all the way down to Montreal's, and an icing is called.
This line for Les Canadiens, LaFour, Aymar, Clément Hadra, are doing a really good job of getting under the skin of Brampton tonight. They've had some good chances to create scoring opportunities on their rushes, but they've been really pesky little pests out there on the ice.
I talked to Clem Alhadra yesterday, actually, about that other gear that she seems to have found in these semifinals. And I asked her, you know, where do you find that extra gear? And her answer was simple. One word, playoffs. When it's the playoffs, you just happen to find that other gear. You dig deep and you find it.
She was a monster when she was in Canadian University hockey when it came to the playoffs with the Martlets.
Lauriane Rougeau crosses the puck across the ice for Carly Hill. They'll knock it forward into Brampton territory where Liz Knox knocks it into the corner. Pile of bodies along the board. Kim Deschaine knocks it in front for Noemi Marin. Her shot is knocked up and into the protective netting.
So let's take a look at how we got to this point with Montreal leading Brampton 3-1. As we spoke with in the intermission, Marie-Philippe Poulin with her first goal of the postseason at 16 seconds from Caroline Ouellette and Anne-Sophie Bette. Then Anso scores shorthanded at 4:50 of the first period. And then at 15:18 of the first period on the power play, it was Poulin with her second. And Ouellette with another assist. Responding for Brampton this evening, it has been Jess Jones with an assist going to Jamie Lee Rattray. All the scoring coming in the first period. Shots on goal thus far, 22 for Les Canadiens, 17 for Brampton.
Courtney Burchard knocks the puck forward for Jamie Lee Rattray, who tries to get a shot through on Labonte, isn't able to do so. Montreal will settle the puck and clear their zone, where Brampton picks it back up in neutralized territory. Burchard dumps it into Montreal's end, goes behind Charlene Labonte, where Lauriane Rougeau leaves it for Carly Hill, up forward for Ouellette. Ouellette trying to clear the zone, isn't able to do so. Carly Hill there to bail her out, carries the puck through neutralized territory and all the way into Brampton's zone. She's all alone as Montreal goes for a line change, hangs onto the puck behind Liz Knox as everybody else skates on. Clem Alhadra, Lafour, and Amard are on the ice. That line has been absolutely wonderful this evening at getting under the skin of Brampton, as John Bauer just said. Sarah Lafour now with a snipe shot in front. Delayed penalty as Charlene Labonte skates off for the extra attacker. The whistle is blown as Brampton touches up. Lafour there with a nice snapshot on Liz Knox. That was knocked away with her glove. And Montreal will head to the power play.
Les Canadiens are 1-for-3 on the hockey game. And that was the goal in the first period at 15-18 by Poulin from Ouellette.
Special teams has been absolutely key for Les Canadiens in this series, going 5-for-11 yesterday, 1-for-3 thus far this afternoon, and also scoring a shorthanded goal. Montreal's PK has been clutch.
That's the key goal right now.
Julie Chu rockets one on Liz Knox, and that one's knocked away into the corner now, where Bette steps in to pick up the puck and send it to the blue line for Ouellette. She fakes the shot, instead passes to Julie Chu. Julie Chu skates to the circle, back up to the blue line for Ouellette. She fakes the shot as well to send it to Poulin instead. Poulin to Ouellette at the blue line. Ouellette to Julie Chu. She takes a look, see who has the best shot. To Ouellette. Back to Julie Chu with the circle. Back to Ouellette, who one times it on Liz Knox, who gets down and knocks it away with her left pad.
That was an outstanding save as she was outstretched, both legs, the arm out, and she just caught that with the toe of her pad to keep it out.
Kim Deschaine now in the offensive zone, goes into the corner with it, knocks it behind Liz Knox. And up front for Anne-Sophie Bette at the circle, she sends it to the blue line for Sarah Lafour. Lafour to Chu. Chu hangs on, sends it back up front for Kim Deschaine. In front of the net is Anne-Sophie Bette. Julie Chu now along the wall for Kathy Chartrand, fresh pair of legs on the ice. She knocks it into the corner. It trickles behind Liz Knox, where Carol Amard will retrieve it. And Brampton tries to clear the zone. Kathy Chartrand holds the puck at the blue line, sends it to Lauriane Rougeau. Rougeau to Amard. Amard at the circle, goes for a skate, back up to the blue line for Rougeau. Sends it back down to Amard, who skates forward, knocks it in front for Sarah Lafour, tries to go in front, isn't able to do so as Brampton clears the zone. With 26 seconds left to play, left in the penalty to Courtney Burchard. Kathy Chartrand skating the puck out of her own zone, sends it forward to Carol Amard, who skates over the blue line and into the corner. She has Sarah Lafour with her. She opts to send it back up to the cross ice blue line, where Lauriane Rougeau settles the puck, sends it over to Chartrand. As Courtney Burchard steps back onto the ice as the power play for Montreal has expired. Burchard now into Montreal territory, where Kathy Chartrand has possession. Sarah LaFour tips it into Brampton territory. Knock forward through center ice. Courtney Burchard will skate off for a line change, as will the rest of the Brampton Thunder. Settling the puck behind Labonte is Poudrier. Poudrier tries to pass it in front, isn't able to get it to one of her own players. Rebecca Vint now tries to send it in front, and no one is there to get the shot off. Jess Jones now battling along the boards with Clément Hadra. She's knocked down by Blay. Coming away with the puck now is Clément Hadra, getting it out of Montreal territory. Knocking it over to Carly Hill. Carly Hill pushes it forward. Marion Alamaz in the corner. Emmanuel Blay. Carolyn Ouellette fires it on Liz Knox, who knocks it up and into the netting.
So Poudrier turns the puck over in the defensive zone, trying to make a relatively simple play up the left boards. And this is one of the things that we're going to see happen in the final 14:38 of this third period. Brampton now is in desperation mode. They're going to be pressing. So what looks like an easy out, you've got to make sure that you hammer it up the boards, you make a hard pass, because Brampton's coming. They're going hard. They're going to try and get to the wall, take away those perceived passing lanes to try and create a turnover and a scoring chance.
Becca King battling along the boards in Montreal territory with Carolyn Ouellette, who falls down on top of her. Julie Chu squeezes the puck out for Poulin on the near side, where Bette knocks it out of her own zone. Courtney Burchard will pick it up at center ice and dump it into Montreal territory and go off for a line change. Julie Chu behind Labonte has the puck now. Skates it forward as Brampton settles onto the ice. Marie-Philippe Poulin in the offensive zone. We're on hat trick watch. Marie-Philippe Poulin has two goals in this game with 13:54 left in the third period. Jamie Lee Rattray gets a shot in on Charlene Labonte. She kicks that away with the right pad as Montreal clears the zone. Brampton with control of the puck in neutralized territory. Jamie Lee Rattray at the blue line knocks it into the Montreal zone. With the puck now is Caitlin Tuga. She knocks it free, does Sarah LaFour, as she tries to bring it into Brampton territory, but that one is kept away from her by Dania Simmons. Carol Lamard now sends a puck in on Liz Knox, who grabs it with the glove and stops the play.
A few moments ago on the right wing side of the offensive zone, Lake Canadian had a chance to get the puck in deep. Brampton again, this is what I'm talking about. They're going to be aggressive. So they went to the puck, intercepted, and were able to get the puck out and create a scoring chance back the other way. Montreal is in control of this hockey game with 13:22 to go. Make the simple plays, be hard, and be decisive. Don't telegraph the pass before you make it. And the Canadien will have a chance to move on to the next round.
Ooh, Jess Jones trips over the center ice line. She had control of the puck and had a whole lot of open ice. That would have been a heck of an opportunity for her.
But Kim Deschen was in offside on the counterattack for the Canadien. A reminder that tomorrow afternoon at 12:45 Mountain Time, 2:45 Eastern Time, Game 3 of the best of three semifinal series between the Toronto Furies and the Calgary Inferno, the defending Clarkson Cup champs, will come your way here on CWHL Live. And next Sunday afternoon, 4 o'clock on Sportsnet, coast to coast in Canada, and on CWHLLive.com. For those who are fans in the United States, it will be the 2017 Clarkson Cup between one of these two teams and either Toronto or Calgary.
Carolyn Ouellette now carries the puck into Brampton's zone, or dumps it in rather, behind Liz Knox, who comes out to play it. Brampton pushing really hard now, trying to get control, get something going, which Rebecca Vint manages to do. She goes in, tries to put one in front for Laura Stacey, isn't able to get her stick on it. Slams her stick down on the ice in frustration. Collision in the corner between Marie-Philippe Poulin and a Brampton player.
And again, when we say a Brampton player, it's because...
it's not that we didn't do our research.
Not at all. It's that Brampton, unfortunately, had to change their uniforms just before the game. And as Robin had mentioned prior to this period, they are wearing the Brassard Stars jerseys, which means that they're wearing another team's jerseys and another team's numbers. So we've our lineup cards, which were all beautifully made long in advance of the game, went out the window about 5 minutes prior to puck drop tonight.
Lauriane Rougeau has it. Knocks it in front for Katia Clément-Hadra, but Brampton clears the zone, and that one will trickle through center ice again, where Jamie Lee Rattray is trying to get hold of it.
And a glove pass called.
12-13 to play here in the third period. 3-1 lead for Montreal. All of the goals scored in the first period. I wonder if that big delay before the second period had anything to do with what we've seen thus far.
Well, Marie-Philippe Poulin did talk about that delay having an impact, and it was tough. They had heavy legs to start that second period, and we noticed that with all the icings in the first 5 minutes, but as things picked up, it started to really really become something that was in the back of their, that was no longer in the back of their minds. And the other thing that, Robin, that was said by Marie-Philippe Poulin, which I found particularly interesting, was that now it's just don't think about tomorrow, think about what they're doing out on the ice and try to do their best on every shift. Keep it simple and advance to the Clarkson Cup championship game.
Noémie Marin has it now in Brampton's zone. She goes to the near side wall, sends it to the blue line for Cassandra Poudrier, who gets a shot through traffic on Liz Knox. Manuel Blais there to try and tip in a rebound, isn't able to do so as Brampton clears the zone. Skating into the offensive now is Brampton's Nicole Brown. A shot goes in on Charlie. She freezes, not quite sure where in her padding the puck is, but she manages to stop the puck. Doesn't squeeze by. 3-1 still the score here with 11-12 left to play in the third period.
Courtney Burchard's long dump in took a bounce between the hash marks, and Charlie was down on the butterfly, and it bounced up, hit her in the breadbasket. And it was, you know, she was looking for the puck going, did it pop through between my legs or not? You know, the goaltenders in tonight's game, we mentioned, Robin, that they had to come up big, and Liz Knox is really making a push to be one of the game's three stars this evening.
Cassandra Poudrier sends the puck along the wall for Carolyn Ouellette at the blue line, trying to clear Montreal territory, unable to do so. Ouellette finally manages to chip it in where Anne-Sophie Bitté has it. She pauses, sends it forward for Marie-Philippe Poulin in the corner. Poulin with it now. In a battle along the boards, Courtney Burchard is there, sends it back to the blue line for Cassandra Poudrier, who had a rocket of a shot just moments ago. Poulet now in front for Ouellette, who bumps up into Rebecca Vint, unable to get a shot off. Laura Stacey now turns the puck over to Bitté, but she can't hold the line. Julie Chu will dump it back into Brampton territory, where Liz Knox will settle the puck down behind her own net. Sarah Lafour is there, leaves the puck for Katia Clément-Hedra. She goes into the corner to retrieve it, plays it along the boards. Carol Amart will chase it as Sarah Lafour is waiting to retrieve the puck. Brampton makes away with it. Jess Jones skating out of Brampton territory, dumping it forward for Caitlin Tuga, who fires the puck behind Charlene Labonte. She settles it. Katia Clément-Hedra picks it up, clears her own zone. Sarah Lafour now skating into Brampton territory. She has Carol Amart with her. She sends it in front for Amart, who isn't able to get a shot off and bounces into the net. Amart behind the net, skating into the corner to grab the puck. Knocks into Shannon McCauley, who falls to the ice. Oh, wanted a call there.
McCauley is livid as she goes to the bench. She did not like the fact that she got upended there and no penalty.
Oh, Lauriane Rougeau setting up Noémie Marin in front of Liz Knox. Top corner beating Liz Knox to make it 4-1 Montreal.
And Robin, that all starts because of the fact that the Brampton player was frustrated, didn't get the call, was slow to get to the bench. Brampton didn't get the quick line change because she wasn't there. The counterattack is set up by Le Canadien on the right side, and a beautiful pass through that is tipped up over the glove of Liz Knox, as we now have experienced a complete power outage here at the Brossard Sports Center with 9:37 to go in the third period. The teams will be sent to their benches.
Just a reminder that it is raining very, very hard here in Montreal today, so it's possible that we have experienced a power loss here in Brossard.
There are thunderstorms going on in the area because of the crazy temperatures.
So it's a good goal for Montreal, no doubt there. 4-1 for Montreal. As you mentioned, Shannon McCauley was really hoping that there would be a call there, that she would have gotten a power play opportunity. You saw how frustrated she was, and this is how important it is to play to the whistle. Just because a call doesn't go your way, you can't whine about it. You gotta play to the whistle.
Exactly.
If the play is moving, you have to play too, otherwise you get scored on.
That's exactly it, Robin. Tonight's game brought to you by Hilberg & Burke, Empowering Women, and we are once again in our third delay, and during the intermission, I happened to be talking with one of the staff members of Le Canadien down at ice level, and I said, you know, So what's the third delay going to be tonight? And the statement was made, well, everything, it always comes in threes, right?
Of course.
And we're just waiting for it. And
jamais
it was
deux sans trois.
Exactly. Exactly. So all of a sudden there's a boom and the lights go out. Now, the rink seems to be on emergency power right now because I'm looking over at the sports domes. The sports fields behind us are dark, and both teams are going to be sent to the locker room now with 9:37 to go here in the third period due to a power outage again here at the Bell Complex in Brossard.
So an interesting day of delays with the jersey delay to start the game, about 20 minutes of a late start because Brampton didn't have the right jerseys, so they had to borrow the Brossard Stars jerseys. As you'll see, they're black, red, and yellow trim jerseys. And then after the first period, we had a problem with the lights, a few of them burning out, and then they decided to go ahead and play anyway. And as they skated out onto the ice, the lights came back on. And just now, with 9:37 left to play in the third period, we've experienced a power failure here in Brossard. There's thunderstorms outside, so it's kind of starting to feel like this game is going to go on forever, John.
It does. The officials are discussing right now out at center ice. As you see how dark it is, the players heading down into the dressing rooms. Now, the emergency lighting is on in the rink. The emergency lighting is on down by the dressing rooms. Behind us in the bar, the most important part of any arena, the lights are still on. However, if we take a look over to our right in the sports fields, it is complete darkness. So there has been a major power outage here in the venue, where you just have to endure this and see where things go. So
Canadian fans rather are making their way out to the bar area where they have the Habs Leafs game on. So with the emergency power, we do have the televisions on, so we're able to watch a 1-0 game in favor of Toronto thus far.
Go Leafs go.
Both teams very involved with CWHL hockey and backing their respective clubs.
And we are not in total darkness here. Just in case you were wondering a moment ago, we are rolling in some sponsor messages here as we try to adjust our cameras because we have been white balanced and everything. And well, okay, we're just gonna hang on a bus. So the game is now in a delay. We will keep things here for a moment. The announcement being made over the public address system saying that there is a delay with the power outage, and we will try to get things back up and running as soon as possible. So,
John, you've called a lot more hockey games than I have in your professional career. Have you ever called a game quite like the one we've been calling this afternoon?
Like I said, Robin, off the top, I've called some crazy games. In North Bay one year, the opening game for the Plymouth Whalers, our broadcast line was not installed in the press box. So we were calling the game behind a plate glass window in a lounge, the bar of the arena, at the end of the rink. I've been in rinks where we've been rained on because some of the old OHL rinks, you know, when it would the thaw, or if it was raining outside in the playoffs, we would get wet. I have concussed myself during a game in the Kitchener Memorial Auditorium, forgetting that there was a steel beam above my head as I...
And you're quite tall.
Yes, as I stood up from calling the game. Despite the fact that my broadcast partner had just previously reminded me, hey, be careful of that. I've almost choked on air because I had eaten popcorn in the pregame.
That's not a smart move.
Eating popcorn before you broadcast?
Eating anything
no.
Right before you broadcast.
No, but eating popcorn is probably the worst because
the
kernel came up in the throat and
oh, my goodness.
That's not a good sound. So I've covered some crazy things. I've done football games.
This collection, floods, though.
But this is nothing like this. Nothing like this.
Usually you get one weird thing happening. This is just a game that doesn't want to be played.
When we got the second crazy thing, that was one. That was what started scaring me. And now we're in delay number three. So the fans slowly heading out into the bar area and that. And, it's a bit of a crazy evening here in Brossard. Please continue to monitor the stream and stay with us. We're going to take a quick timeout, and as soon as we have some more information, we will be back to conclude, hopefully, this second game of this best of three series, with Montreal leading 4-1 with 9:37 to go in the third period. You're watching CWHL Live.
Previously on Heroes of Hockey Day, we've selected three teams, and the winner goes to Scotiabank Hockey Day in Canada.
You girls gotta know, this competition is going to be tough. There's this team from Burlington.
One in Calgary.
And then there's one more.
All right, you guys ready? Let's do this.
One, two, three, go!
Do you guys have any idea why I'm here?
No.
What you guys have done for new Canadians. I'm truly inspired.
There's a lot of barriers for newcomer kids to meet Canadian-born children.
We were thinking, how could we make it better for them? So we thought we'd kind of try to break the ice.
Can you push as hard as you can down on your leg?
This will be our third year doing the new Canadian Skate. They see other kids who want to experience skating for the first time.
Aaron, just try and go slow. You're doing great right now, actually.
But to skate, you would see our kids out teaching new Canadians how to skate.
Good job, wow.
So we leave as much of that as possible up to the kids.
It's not just about the skating, it's get to know them.
I met some friends here. Yeah, they're really nice, they're really helpful, you know?
You guys need some help?
I don't think we've got a response to anything we've ever done quite like we have for the new Canadian Skate. We do food drives and we do toy drives at Christmas. This is something that hits a little bit deeper in the heart. It talks to the entire community. I think they're showing the best, not of just Canada, but of who they are as well.
Scotiabank scoured the country for three teams for this competition. And guys, you are one of them. I'm gonna be here to mentor you, coach you, and we're gonna do this together as a team. And you know what? We got some tough competition.
We're gonna make you work hard. You're gonna have to dig deeper than you ever have before.
Oh, come on, are you ready for this?
Yes!
Can you believe in me?
Yeah!
One, two, three, go!
Get ready for Toronto!
I'm feeling a bit anxious, not knowing what's going to happen.
Go, boys, come on, go, guys.
We all know girls are better than boys. No offense, but this challenge is ours. We're going to own it.
I heard that this challenge will be hosted by a hockey legend.
Everyone, I'm going to be your host.
We are still in a delay here at the Complexe Sportif Bell in Brossard, Quebec, with Les Canadiens leading the Brampton Thunder 4-1 in the third period of game number two of their best of three CWHL semifinal series. And we will continue to monitor the progress of the delay and come back in a few moments' time. This is CWHL Live.
We've selected three teams. You guys are one of them. Do you want to know who you're up against?
Testing, one, two, three. Come on, guys. I'm sure you're wondering, why are we here, right? When I heard about what you did, I had to meet you. I'm so inspired by what you did to help kids with cancer and to honor Jordan.
Jordan?
Jordan was very active. I could not keep up with that kid.
As a wee little one, he just was on the go constantly. I went through many knees on my jeans playing with him, keeping up with him.
I can't describe how much he loved hockey. It was his whole world. He was 7 years old, and our worst fears were confirmed that he had a tumor. Jordan was terminal. He survived for 8 months.
Right there. There you go.
We're lucky as a family. We didn't have to face this alone. The hockey community in particular, they had our back the whole time. They rallied around us, and they had silent auctions, and as a result, that allowed us to start a foundation in Jordan's honor. You know, we raised some money that can help the researchers, you know, get closer to a cure for this thing.
Coach Dillon taught me to play hockey when I was 5. He tried to make him feel happier, but it's really hard since Jordan was also our friend, so we were all sad as well.
When I hit the ice with those kids, that was my safe place. That was the only place that felt right.
I wanted to make a difference, and I didn't want to see anyone else suffer through the same thing that I saw what Jordan suffered through. We decided as a team to cut our hair together.
Georgia, Georgia, Molly, Molly, yay!
He said, you know, Mom, it's for kids who go through chemotherapy because kids have cancer. And I mean, she saw that firsthand.
My hair looks kind of like a Christmas tree.
It speaks of the character of those kids. Some little girl somewhere will really appreciate that gesture.
This is the most unbelievable way to honor Jordan as a team. You girls have done something very special, and that's why you've been selected for a competition. If you girls win, you're going to Scotiabank Hockey Day in Canada. You girls gotta know, this competition is going to be tough.
Hey everyone, I'm going to be your host. Inferno, you're up first.
Go, Cali, go!
Double check him!
The Calgary Inferno with less than a minute to go.
And if you're just joining us, you'll notice there was another delay here at the CWHL Live Clarkson Cup playoff semifinal matchup between Montreal and Brampton. 9:37 left to go in the third period. Power failure. John Bauer is standing by ringside with an update.
Thank you very much, Robin. So what is happening is that there is a system of severe thunderstorms passing through the area. And what it does is that it knocks out the power in the building. The lights here are mercury lights, so it takes about 15-20 minutes for them to heat back up. So once the power is disconnected, they go out, and then it takes 15-20 minutes for the lights to heat back up. And we are approaching getting ready to go back on the ice to complete this hockey game, barring any other unforeseen circumstances. But the team should be back out on the ice in about 2 minutes' time to restart the third period with the Canadiens leading 4-1. So that's where things stand here at ice level. Robin, I'm coming back up to join you in the booth in just a moment.
Thanks so much, John, for the update at ice level. We are getting ready to get started back here at the Bell Sports Complex in Brossard. Reminder that the score is 4-1 in favor of Les Canadiens with 9:37 left to play in the third period. Your goal scorer in the third period literally shut out the lights. Noémie Marin scoring her first of the playoffs. And as she was celebrating her goal, the lights went out. So we thank you for your patience, for sticking by with us on CWHL Live throughout these delays this afternoon. But that's three, right? And bad things come in threes. So I think it's over, it's done with, and we're going to play the next 9 minutes and 37 seconds of hockey without any hitches or delays here in Brossard as we wait for the players to come back out onto the ice. As John Bauer was going to be rejoining me in the broadcast booth momentarily. An entertaining afternoon of hockey. When you ignore all the delays and everything that happened this afternoon, the game itself has been really, really entertaining, John. Seeing the offense and seeing these teams power through the adversity that both of them are facing right now as the official is skating back out onto the ice.
Well, what we saw in the second period, Robin, when everybody came back out onto the ice, was having heavy legs. Brampton doesn't have the time to be able to play around. They're down by 3 goals now. And unless they can find a way to kick a field goal, which is not possible in women's hockey the last time I checked, but they're going to have to really come out quick. So it's unfortunate for the Thunder that this keeps happening because it will affect them more than the Canadiens because they're the ones that are down in the series by a game facing elimination, and the ones that now have to fight back from a 3-goal deficit with 9 minutes and 37 seconds.
It's interesting that the Thunder has the Thunder to blame this afternoon. With severe thunderstorms moving through the area, we've had rain all day. It's just been a downpour. Basically, as long as I was outside, it was a torrential downpour for the afternoon, and it's been really, really crazy here this afternoon. As we're about to get back underway as the players have made their way to the bench. They're going for a little bit of a skate, and we will get going here shortly. 4-1 the score, 9:37 left to play in the third period, and hopefully that will be 9 minutes and 37 seconds of uninterrupted hockey, and this game will end.
So let's go down the scoring summary since we've got a moment here. So 16 seconds into the game, it was Marie-Philippe Poulin opening the scoring, then a 4:50 shorthanded Anne-Sophie Batté made it 2-0 for Les Canadiens. Coming back was Jess Jones on the power play at 6:23 of the first period to make it 2-1. But Marie-Philippe Poulin, second of the game, made it 3-1. And here in the third period, it was Noémie Marin just moments ago on the clock, making it 4-1.
And Marie-Philippe Poulin wins the draw against Rebecca Vint, sends it back into her own zone. Julie Chu has it now in the corner up along the boards for Anne-Sophie Batté. But Poulin gets it. Sends it out for Chartrand, who loses the puck to Laura Stacey. Puck in front of Charlene Labonte. She's trying to find the puck, sprawls out in front, and manages to keep it out of her net. 9:16 to play in the third period.
So driving off of the right wing side was number 38, Rebecca Vint. And as she took it to the net, Labonte goes down to the butterfly, and everybody collapses down upon her, and Vint was trying to just punch the puck in between the post and Charlene's skate.
Shannon McCauley wins the draw, sends it back as Montreal skates it out and into Brampton's zone. Carol Amard has it now. Takes a shot on Liz Knox. That one is knocked in front and stopped by Liz. Montreal unable to get a rebound. Brampton has control of the puck now. Jamie Lee Rattray skating into Montreal territory. Fires it in on Charlene Labonte, who makes the save.
So end-to-end action. Like, and I didn't get a chance at one end. Good stop by Knox on the initial shot. And the rebound was corralled by Brampton, although they could have had an opportunity to tuck it back home. And then Brampton on the counterattack come back quickly with a shot on goal. So we played just over a minute since we've been back, Robin, and we've had three scoring chances already.
No more heavy legs for these girls. I guess they were keeping themselves loose during that last delay. We don't usually expect to have rain delays in hockey games, but that's what we had.
And a glove pass called here by the back official. As Nicole Brown was on the ice, and she's going, but I was down and I used my stick with my hand.
Can't do that, Nicole. So we'll come for the faceoff just outside of Brampton's zone. Alamaz will take the draw, lining up. She wins it, sends it back for Carly Hill. Hill to Poudrier. Poudrier fires it into the Brampton zone, and that puck is blocked by Taylor Woods. Brampton clears their own territory. Skating in now to Montreal's zone is Kristen Richards. Montreal clears their zone and will go off for a line change as the puck trickles behind Liz Knox. Ouch. Is that Bakia? Collided into the boards there. She gets up. She looks fine. Sends the puck back, and they lose the blue line there. 4 acres for Rougeau. They change spots. Rougeau along the boards. Back up for 4 acres on the far side. Clears Montreal territory. But Brampton is there and coming back in. Jocelyn LaRocque in the corner.
So she was spun around, and an interference call coming up here against LeCanadien.
Huge power play opportunity for the Brampton Thunder, with Brittany 4 acres getting called for interference and heading into the penalty box.
So a critical juncture in the hockey game. 7:54 to go in regulation time. Brampton needs one on this power play to get back in the game and then to work the rest of the clock to try and create a tie.
Their lone marker in this game was scored on the power play, so if they're going to get on the board at any point, this is the time to do it. In their own zone now is Laura Fortino. She sends the puck up forward, dumps it into Montreal's territory. In the corner where Julie Chu picks it up, knocks it forward for Carolyn Ouellette. Ouellette for Marie-Philippe Poulin. She skates in with speed. Short-handed attempt by Marie-Philippe Poulin. Sends it in on Liz Knox. That one's wide. Carol Amard at the blue line, hanging on to it. High slot. At the circle now, she drops to her knee to take a shot on Liz Knox, and that one goes up high.
This is not the power play that Brampton envisioned, with two scoring chances by Lee Kennedy and short-handed.
Jamie Lee Rattray battling for the puck along the boards. She's got Bate there. And Rattray manages to get a shot off on Labonte.
Again, high on the blocker side, eh?
Yeah, it seems to be where they're shooting on Charlie this afternoon, this evening.
Tonight.
Tonight.
Started out this afternoon.
Yeah. Ooh, Brampton tripped up there by Carol Amard. Gets the puck in anyway on Charlene Labonte. In the corner, battle for the puck. Brampton comes away with it. Up to the blue line, settling it down, down into the corner, looking for somebody in front of the net. A rocket of a shot in on Labonte, doesn't get through traffic. Poudrier picks it up in the corner, and she will clear Montreal's zone with 22 seconds left to go in the penalty to Brittany 4 acres.
That was a much better sequence there by the Brampton Thunder, keeping the puck in the offensive zone and getting some traffic in front of Labonte. And a couple of high shots trying to pick up the rebounds, as Jess Jones told us in the first intermission. They're trying to get the rebounds on the veteran netminder for Lake Canadien.
Jenna McParlin with speed into the offensive zone. She loses control of the puck, though. Katia Klimahedra knocks it away and sends it to Lauriane Rougeau. Rougeau behind Charlene Labonte for Julie Chu. Julie Chu chips it forward to the blue line, where Katia Klimahedra is there with Mahe. Puck knocked into Brampton territory. And they'll clear it into neutralized territory. Rebecca Vint with it now. She loses it to Katia Klimahedra, isn't able to get a shot off. Rebecca Vint behind her own net, falls to her knees, where Marin will come to pick up the puck. She trips over Rebecca Vint. Puck knocked behind Liz Knox and into the corner.
So we're starting to see now, Robin, what the benchmark's going to be for a penalty here late in this hockey game. It's going to be interference taking or something that creates or takes away a scoring chance.
A long pass or a long shot on Charlene Labonte. She knocks it away into the corner. Brampton comes away with it. Caitlin Tuga on the ice. She has the puck. She fans on an attempted shot. Mary Philippe Plain clears the puck, sends it forward for Anne-Sophie Bette. 3-on-2, skating now. Ouellette from Bette. She takes the shot. That one doesn't get through on Liz Knox. In the corner, Bette knocks it behind the net for Ouellette. She tries to center it in front for Boulin. She isn't able to get a shot off, and Brampton will clear. Come back into Montreal territory where Courtney Burchard gets tangled with Anne-Sophie Bette. No penalty.
That not a penalty, Robin?
Laura Fortino tries to get a shot off. That's wide on Charlene Labonte. Carolyn Ouellette picks it up, clears the zone.
It was a good back check by Bette.
Lauriane Rougeau in on Liz Knox. She makes the initial save and almost knocks it into her own net. Fortunately, that bounced behind the net as Brampton on the counterattack comes into Montreal territory. Laura Stacey in the corner, battling for the puck with Julie Chu. Laura Fortino has it now. Goes for a bit of a skate. Sends it in front to go for Charlene Labonte and isn't able to get it through. Brampton has pulled their goalie with 3:52 left. Sarah LaFord tries to shoot into the empty net, isn't able to get it in. Katia Klimahedra now. Shot blocked in front by Laura Stacey. Brampton has the extra attacker now with 3:38. With Tyler Fiennes going by the Patrick Waugh rule book of coaching.
Well, right now they have no choice. They're down by 3 and time is really of the essence. They need to score one very soon if they're going to get back in this game.
Kim Deschaine scores the fifth goal of the game for Montreal in an empty net goal with 3:21 left in the third period, pretty much sealing Brampton's fate. It looks like Montreal has punched their ticket to the Clarkson Cup final, John.
For the third straight year, they Kenna Jan are going to be back in the championship game, up 5-1 with 3:21 to go in the third period, Robin. And you know, Brampton, I want to go back to the play that may have destabilized them. They had a chance to get a good scoring chance, and Sophie Bette comes back. She stick checks the player, but then kind of skis behind her, and Brampton wanted a penalty. Something that happened on the fourth goal. Brampton wanted a penalty called. They didn't continue playing. And as a result, it ends up in the back of the cage eventually, but this time was Brampton having the empty net.
Brampton still putting pressure on Montreal. You're seeing Montreal's fourth line out there quite a bit with Alamaz, Perroff, and Bakia getting significant amounts of ice time. Players you don't usually see out on the ice. Montreal now with a four-goal lead with 3 minutes left to play in the third period. Brampton's trying to get shots, anything they can, in on Charlene Labonte. A pile of bodies falling in front of Charlene Labonte. Brampton puts a shot in on Kristen Richards does for Brampton, but isn't able to beat Charlene Labonte, who has been absolutely outstanding this afternoon.
And Robin, the interesting thing now is, as you mentioned, the fourth line getting more and more time out on the ice. You're going to see probably the number one lot unit, which comes out right now, once, maybe twice more. You don't want to risk an injury at this point in time. The series is locked up at this point in time. I don't think that Denis Brunet is going to risk any type of injuries going into the Clarkson Cup Championship.
Especially when you consider how things devolved yesterday at the end of the hockey game with three Brampton Thunders getting ejected from the game as Montreal just gets a shot in on Liz Knox. Marie-Philippe Poulin on the ice. Hopefully she won't be seeing too much more of her in this hockey game.
So they can again with a pair of goals here in this third period to put the game away. They're out shooting Brampton 8-4 in this last stanza.
Poulin loses the draw, but manages to get the puck anyway. She gets knocked up along the boards. Carrying the puck up now is Laura Fortino. She sends it forward for Jamie Lee Rattray in Montreal territory. She fires it in on Charlene Labonte. She makes the save. Puck bounces out into the corner where Carly Hill will try to clear it. Brampton holds it in. Liz Knox still in goal. Montreal clears the puck and goes for a line change. Picking up the puck now is Jocelyn LaRocque. She sends it forward to neutralized territory and back into the Montreal end, where Julie Chu will skate into the corner to retrieve the puck, dump it in behind Labonte, and back up forward for Alamaz. She'll skate into Brampton zone. She pauses, sends it back to the blue line for Poudrier. Poudrier to Julie Chu. Julie Chu to Jordana Peroff. Peroff to Chu. Chu to Poudrier. She takes a shot in on Liz Knox. She makes an impressive move to try and keep that puck out of the net.
She was falling backwards as she went down to the butterfly. That's an incredible stop.
Alamaz in the corner, sending it out for Jordana Peroff. Peroff back to Alamaz. Alamaz gets the puck through. Liz Knox makes a sprawling save. As Bakia tries to put the puck back on net, isn't able to do so. Alamaz at the corner wall. Sends it back to the point for Julie Chu. Chu fakes a shot, settles the puck, looks towards Liz Knox as she gets set, dumps it into the corner where Peroff tips it back into the other corner. Bakia is there as Montreal will go for a change. Brampton gaining control of the puck is Jamie Lee Rattray. She dumps it into Montreal territory and goes for a line change herself. Last minute of play here in game two of the best of three semifinals. Montreal with a 5-1 lead on the Brampton Thunder. Brampton in Montreal's zone. Trying to clear the puck now is Brittany Foracres. Having some trouble doing so as Brampton is pushing. Katia Klimal-Hedra dumps the puck out and into neutralized territory. Brampton tries to settle it, moving back in where Laura Fortino misses a pass. She grabs this one, though, and skates over the blue line. 27 seconds as she tries to put a shot through on Charlene Labonte. Doesn't make it through traffic. Foracres clears it behind Labonte and into the corner. Klimal-Hedra picks it up. 19 seconds left to play in the third period. Montreal clears their zone. Katia Klimal-Hedra at the Montreal bench passes it out. Brampton going in for a last-second attempt on Charlene Labonte. 5 seconds remaining in the third period. As the Canadiens de Montréal will make their third straight Clarkson Cup final appearance as they punch their ticket. I'll see you in Canada. As Montreal celebrates a semifinal victory over the Brampton Thunder here at the Bell Sports Complex in Brossard. An entertaining series. This best of three series was as Montreal sweeps it in two games as the players line up at center ice for the traditional handshake. A hard-fought series, a tough battle. The Brampton Thunder should be extremely proud of everything they accomplished this season. The steps that they took over their play from last year were tremendous. The talent gap in the CWHL is bridging. There is so much exciting women's hockey to come for this team. And the Brampton Thunder have absolutely nothing to be ashamed of. Tyler Fine should be very proud of the team that he assembled this season, as should Danny Brunet and Lisa Marie Breton-Lebreux, who are sending their team to the Clarkson Cup final next weekend, Sunday afternoon at the Canadian Tire Centre in Kanata, Ontario. 4 p.m. start. You can buy tickets on thecwhl.com. For $20. You can also watch the game on Sportsnet Coast to Coast. If you're in the U.S., you can watch it on our webcast, as you have been doing this afternoon. And John Bauer is standing by at ice level. He'll be speaking with Anne-Sophie Bété, who had a shorthanded goal and an assist in this hockey game. She added a couple of helpers yesterday in Montreal's 7-1 Game 1 victory over Brampton as Montreal takes to center ice to salute their fans for the final time this season, thanking them. Another sold-out crowd, as was often the case this season. The Canadiens fans are some of the best in the league. They stuck with this team through all the delays this afternoon, and were they ever rewarded? Les Canadiens are going to the Clarkson Cup final next weekend. Who they'll be facing remains to be seen, as Toronto and Calgary will be going to a third decisive game tomorrow afternoon, with Toronto winning game one by a score of 5-2. Janelle Kohanchuk with a hat trick, but Calgary winning 3-1 this afternoon. The final game will be played tomorrow in Calgary, and you can catch that one as well on CWHL Live at 12:45 Mountain Time, 2:45 Eastern, right here on CWHL Live. You can still hear the sounds of the crowd hooting and hollering, cheering. Their team is headed to the Clarkson Cup final. They have plenty to be excited about this afternoon. as Bleu Blanc Rouge plays at the Bell Sports Complex in Brossard. Traditional song heard at the Bell Center, where the Habs play. And we're getting the three-star announcement now as we wait for the player interview that John Bauer will be conducting with Anne-Sophie Bété after the game. And defender Lauriane Rougeau being named the third star of the game. She had a beautiful setup on the Noémie Marin goal in the third period that put the Canadiens up 4-1 here at the Bell Sports Complex in Brossard. And Sophie Bété being named the game's second star, a shorthand goal and an assist this afternoon for Anne-Sophie Bété, who is also a talented musician, takes piano lessons and singing lessons as well. And I'll give you one guess as to who the first star of this hockey game is. She had two goals this afternoon, including one on the power play. And Marie-Philippe Poulin is named the game's first star. She skates out to the thunderous applause of the faithful here at the Bell Sports Complex in Brossard. It's a good thing she's not a ball player. Can't quite get that gift up over the board for the fans. She manages on the second attempt. We'll forgive her. I figure two Olympic gold medal winning goals, that's good enough. Game's first star here in Montreal's 5-1 win over the Brampton Thunder. Brampton's season is over, unfortunately. Montreal's is not. They'll be headed to the Clarkson Cup final next weekend to be played at the Canadian Tire Centre in Kanata, Ontario. A 4 p.m. start next Sunday. Tickets available online at thecwhl.com. You can also watch the game on Sportsnet as the game's three stars get together to pose for a picture. Lauriane Rougeau and Sophie Bété and Marie-Philippe Poulin. John Bauer is standing by ringside with Anne-Sophie Bété, and we'll head now to John Bauer, where he is joined by the game's second star.
Thank you very much, Robin. Anne-Sophie Bété, the second star of today's game. And so walk us through the shorthanded goal that was the backbreaker in today's contest.
Well, I mean, Carol and the defense did some great pressure, and then that girl passed me the puck, they were under pressure. I went along and the defense didn't have speed, so I just tried to chip the puck around and went around, and luckily it went blocker side and it went in. I was really happy.
So now you qualify for the Clarkson Cup. Some unfinished business from the last couple of seasons. How do you prepare for this championship compared to the two previous years?
Well, I think we have a great team this year. We just have to keep doing the things that we've been building throughout the season. And we've been having some success, so I guess it's going to keep things simple and then have fun and play as a team.
Which team do you prefer, Toronto or Calgary, as they go into Game 3 tomorrow?
Doesn't matter. As long as we're there, doesn't matter.
Well, and so thank you very much. Congratulations on the victory tonight, and good luck next week in the Clarkson Cup Championship.
Thank you.
And Sophie Bété, the second star in tonight's game. Back to you, Robin, in the booth.
Thank you, John. That was Anne-Sophie Bété, the game's second star, a shorthanded goal and an assist this afternoon. This game has been brought to you by Hilberg and Burke. They empower female athletes, and if you have a chance to go to their website, buy a pair of those beautiful sparkle ball earrings that you see all the CWHL athletes wearing. I can't wait to go home and buy myself a pair this evening to celebrate Le Canadien victory. For John Bauer, here at the Bell Sports Complex in Brossard, a 5-1 win for Le Canadien. They're headed to the Clarkson Cup final next weekend. Thanks to everybody here in the booth, and thanks to you for watching. I'm Robin Flynn. Have a great evening.